Racing from Aintree, now on BBC Two, day one of the Grand National Meeting, introduced by Julian Wilson.
Months have slipped away and we're back in the cradle of dreams. Last year Royal Athletes stole the glory and party politics chased him home. Now Royal Athletes retired with honour, but the 12-year-old party politics tries again. A welcome to Aintree 96, the stage for the richest ever Martel Grand National. In fact, it's the richest steeplechase ever run in Europe. It's also a national with the smallest field since 1970. Only 28 were confirmed at today's final declaration, and the sensational news is that Lo Stregoni, the second favourite, is out of the race with equine flu. A real heartbreak for his connections, especially his trainer Thomas Tate. We'll be speaking to him in a few moments. Well, he was one of four horses withdrawn this morning. The others were Tartan Tyrant, for whom the ground's going to be fast. It's too fast, it's drying up all the time here. And two others, Dextra Dove and Too Good to Be True, who were withdrawn yesterday. So, these now, the 28, which barring accidents, will face the starter on Saturday. Headed by Young Hustler. The fast ground's going to suit him down to the ground, as it will the number one Irish contender, Son of War. He's down to 7-1 now. Lusty Light is a second string for Jenny Pitman, an old party politics. He bids to become the first horse since 1853 to win a race after a gap of 4 years. Superior finish is Jenny Pittman's number one. Tartan Tyrant and Lo Stregoni confirmed non-runners. Some outsiders. The ground certainly going against the Irish contender Wild Hyde, who was well backed last week. Martin Pipe has a strong hand. He's got three runners, two of them a Riverside Boy and Encore un peu. We're down amongst the outsiders now, and amongst them Over the Deal, who finished third at a big price last year. And these are the real rank outsiders. Vicomte de Valmont might have run well if the ground had been soft. Three brownies, Paul Carberry switches to him now that Tartan Tyrant has been withdrawn. And number 32, the bottom weight, a famous Aintree name, Donald McCain, riding for his father Ginger. And so, inevitably, with the withdrawal of Lo Stregoni, Rough Quest shortens again, heading the market now on 9-2. Then it's 7-1 Superior Finish, 8-1 Young Hustler, Deep Ramble and Son of War, 11-1 Party Politics, 12-1 Life of the Lord, 14 Wild Hyde and 20 Lusty Light. It's 25-1 Encore un peu, 33-1 Rust Never Sleeps and Antonin and Bishop's Hall, 50-1 Captain Dibble, Chatham, Sir Peter Lely, Over the Deal and Into the Red, 66-1 Vicomte de Valmont and Bavardier, 80-1 Riverside Boy and 100-1 Over the Stream, as are Plastic Space Age, Brackenfield and Greenhill Raffles. It's 150-1 Far Senior and Three Brownies, and 200-1 the rank outsider Sure Metal. So it's so near, yet so far for Lo Stregoni and Thomas Tate, just 48 hours before the race withdrawn. Because, well, you'll hear why now, because I can welcome Thomas. Thomas, you must be absolutely gutted.
Yeah, yes, devastated, really.
How's it come about?
On Tuesday night, we took his the pre-race blood test, and we had a suspicion then. But the horse was fine. He was like a fighting cock. So we just watched him, and on Wednesday he was a bit quieter. On Wednesday night he had a temperature, and he had a temperature this morning, and he left his breakfast this morning, and he was quiet this morning. And that's not him.
So that was it. Is that him finished for the season now?
Well, believe it or not, he's the last of my horses in the yard to have this, and we were hoping we were going to miss it. Started when a horse came back in December from the races with it. Now they've all followed a similar pattern. It's taken them about a week and taken another fortnight thereafter to come back to their full powers. So the Scottish National may be a possibility.
It's easy to say now, but would he have won?
Oh, I thought he was a real Aintree horse, you know. Jumps and stays and a real operator. But never mind. We'll have to try to come back next year and prove it.
Well, we hope you'll do that, and we wish you luck with Ask Tom later on.
Thank you.
That's Thomas Tate. Well, sadly, in the last 12 months, the greatest Aintree hero of all has passed away. That's Red Rum. Red Rum was buried here at Aintree. His commemoration stone was unveiled yesterday by Ginger McCain. We pay tribute to him later in the programme. And still the most tangible memorial to the old horse are the Grand National fences that he jumped with such thrilling abandon. Beecher's Brook, 4'10" at the takeoff, but 6'9" on the landing side. The fearsome ditch may be filled in, but it remains the most famous fence in the world. The canal turn, a unique challenge with its turn of 90 degrees. Woe betide any horse that gallops straight on, he'll end up in the canal. And the biggest obstacle of all, the fearsome chair, 5'3" tall with a spread of 13 feet. This is the fence that catches out runners on the first 2 days. Well, a man feeling much braver now than when he faced it on horseback, Peter Scudamore. Peter, how does it look today?
Yes, it still looks very big, Julian. It's beautifully made. The whole course looks in wonderful condition.
Well, today in the John Hughes, it's the third fence, of course, and year after year, you find that they're going a little bit too fast at it.
Yes, we've had a lot of controversy over the starts at Cheltenham, and I think we'll see the same here today. The start is very, very important in the John Hughes. Your position early is vital, and the trouble is that you can be going too fast by the time you get to this fence.
Well, the going is officially good. How is it walking to you?
Yes, I've just had a look out onto the track where they run for the first race there, and they're hardly kicking up at all. It's probably just not really bouncing good ground yet, but if this sun and the wind keep up, it's going to be very fast ground by Saturday.
Well, Peter, thank you very much. You can come back into the warm now. It's certainly going to become drier as the week goes on. And the security measures here at Aintree this year, well, they're the most stringent ever. On Saturday, there'll be over 400 police officers on duty to maintain law and order. There'll be at least one security man at every fence. This is the rundown towards Beecher's. This will be particularly well protected, and there's reinforced metal fencing both down in that part of the course and behind the grandstand where crowds tend to congregate. There's improved closed circuit television surveillance, 18 cameras now monitored in an on-site police control room, and every day the management are updating their security strategy with the police. So wrongdoers, beware. Well, this is a real three-day festival now at Aintree, and we've got a terrific first day program. We start at 2:35 with the most valuable race of the first day, the Martel Cup Chase. At 3:10 is the Sandeman McGall Novices Chase, a Grade 1 event. At 3:45, the first race of the meeting over the Grand National fences. They jump 18 in all in the John Hughes Memorial Trophy. And at 4:20, the Glenlivet Anniversary Hurdle. It's one of the top four-year-old races of the year. And a couple of non-runners we have in the third race. Number 3, Captain Khedive, doesn't go. And in the fourth race, number 1, Escart Fee. Well, the first race today set the standard for the meeting. It was a terrific race, some top horses in the Seagram Top Novices Hurdle. And the race, the horse they made favourite was Kim and Nicky. He was challenged for favouritism by Castle Sweep, but he went off best 3-1. 7-2 Castle Sweep, 15-2 Shankar, the stable companion to Castle Sweep, 8-1 Speedwell Prince, 8-1 Jenny Pippman's Master Tribe, 10-1 Master Bevelt, 14 Charming Girl, and Lake Kariba, 16-1 Bar. John Hanmer picks up the story.
As they come now to the third from home, Master Bevel making good headway. So is Frozen Sea, a lot in with a chance as they jump three out. And Charming Girl and Castle Sweep took it together. Here comes Master Bevel on the outside, Kim and Nicky on the inside, but it's Charming Girl who's taking it up at the second last. Master Bevel down on his nose, and Tragic Hero running on the inside. Shankar's running on with Kim and Nicky. Still plenty in with a chance as they come to the last. Charming Girl from Kim and Nicky. Tragic Hero getting through on the inside. Then on the outside, Shankar and Master Bevel. And Tragic Hero's come through on the inside to take it up with 150 yards to race. Tragic Hero from Charming Girl, Kim and Nicky, Shankar and Castle Sweep. But going up to the line, Tragic Hero and Jonathan Lauer win from Charming Girl. Castle Sweep stays on to be third, ahead of Kim and Nicky, Shankar and Master Bevel.
Great race, not such a great result. The winner, number 15, Tragic Hero, 20-1. Second, number 12, Charming Girl at 14-1. Third, number 5, Castle Sweep at 7-2. So, first blood to the bookmakers, and here with this morning's betting news is Graham Rock. Graham?
Yes, Tragic Hero for the bookmakers, a tragic start for punters down here. A difficult card, the ground drying out. This morning the professionals stayed away rather, but one or two interesting bets later on. But let's start with the big race of the day over the Grand National Fences, the John Hughes Memorial Chase. Joint favourites here, Old Bridge and Tureen Prince at 7-1, money with Ladbrokes there for Tureen Prince, 15-year-old. As you can see, most of them static. Romany King clipped in there, 16-1 from 20-1. And in our next race, we've got 20-1 from 25, Budder Lane, another outsider, well backed. Now some real action here. Debutante Days put in early, 9-2, right down to 3-1 favourite, and the big gamble too on Edelweiss Dumoulin, 5-1 into 7-2, and Bets of London of 6,002 Debutante Days, and a little bit of money for Amla, 100-1 to 50-1 with the tote. Moving on now to the Sandeman McGold Novices Chase, Manhattan Castle, Irish Challenger, well backed, clear favourite 11-4 from 100-30. But a gamble here on Lord Dorset, 6-1 from 10-1, general across all bookmakers. Cumbrian Challenge nipped in there by one or two shrewd bookmakers, 10 from 100-8. And finally, in this race, couldn't be better, was 2-1 this morning. Nobody wanted to back him. He's out to at least 9-4 here on the course. Money 2 for Scott and Banks, 7-2 from 4. Barton Bank easy to back out to 4-1. And Unguided Missile and Egypt Mill Prince both attracting good support.
Graham, thank you. My guest today is the man who 12 months ago became the first jockey for 34 years to win the Gold Cup and the Champion Hurdle in the same year. He is, of course, Norman Williamson. Norman's still sitting it out with injury, but conditions look perfect, well, for fast ground horses anyway, don't they?
Yes, it looks quite quick. The first race, it was typical Liverpool, they were coming home quick.
One horse for you to focus on today?
I was just looking, I think Egypt Mill Prince, he's a 10-1 shot, I think he's a great price, he's coming here fresh. And he really, I think he's a horse that who deserves to win a big race. He ran a cracking race in the Racing Post behind Rough Quest. And all going right, he's going to have a big run today, but he has a lot in his plate.
Well, I'll go along with that. He's one of six in this richest race of the first day. It's the Martell Cup Chase. Runners and riders from Peter O'Sullivan.
Three Grand National jockeys involved here. Number one, Barton Bank, ridden by Tony McCoy, who rides Deep Bramble in the big one. Two is Black Humour, Jamie Osborne. Three, Couldn't Be Better, Graham Bradley. Four, Egypt Mill Prince, written by Warren Marston, who rides Lusty Light in the Martell Grand National. Five is Scott and Banks, written by Lorcan Waugh. And six is Unguided Missile, written by Richard Dunwoody, who rides Superior Finish on Saturday.
And Couldn't Be Better, very, very weak here, opened to 7-4. now 9-4, 5-2 in places. Scott and Banks and Barton Banks both 4-1, together with Unguided Missile. More money for Egypt Mill Prince, 8s into 7s, and Black Humour, the outside of the 6, 12-1 from 14-1.
Well, I reckon this race is ripe for a shock result. The two outsiders of the two for money there you saw, one of them, Egypt Mill Prince, from 8-7. And he's now comfortable racing over 3 miles, but of course he started the season racing over 2 miles, and this win at Ascot showed real determination. It was a terrific race. He took it up from Clay County between the last two, and then they were queuing up to beat him. Storm Alert with the yellow sleeves, who'd won the race the previous 2 years. Big Matt, who went on to win the Victor Chandler, he's on the outside. What's in Orbit, what a race. And they battled all the way to the line. In the olden days, some people questioned Egypt Mill Prince's courage, but Norman, he really put it in here, didn't he?
Well, it's one of his best runs for a while. He stuck his head down, he kept battling. A lot of people say sometimes he's a bit of a coward, but definitely on this occasion he wasn't. And I think the step up and trip is a big help to him. It just helps him travel that bit more. And hopefully he can spring a little bit of a surprise.
And it's his ground today. It's the scenario which Jenny Pittman has found so happy in the past. 7-1 from 8-1. Here are Richard and Scu.
Yes, fascinating race this. We don't need a big field with chasers like this to get good action. Won by an Irish horse last year, Merry Gale, given a great ride by Graham Bradley. And he's on Couldn't Be Better today for Charlie Brooks. And it is, in fact, the best turned out horse in this race. And Jack Nelson, who's been in Lambourne for a very long time, gets a handsome present from the sponsor there. 5-2 from 2-1. He's still friendless, and this would be totally because of the ground. Scu, you've been out there. I mean, he ran a good race in the Gold Cup, but when he won the Hennessy, it was soft.
Yeah, I spoke to Charlie earlier. He is worried about the ground. Interesting, this horse had been to Italy before he ran in the Gold Cup to bring him on through the, so he didn't have the harsh winter here. And Charlie's interested to know, should he have given him a run before the Gold Cup? And if he really improves today, he thinks that the Gold Cup's brought him on. I looked him in the paddock at the Gold Cup, and he did look a bit burly, but he looked very well there, doesn't he?
I think he looks spot on, and they say they've weighed him. He's at his fighting weight. He is prone to breaking blood vessels, but plenty more interest in this race. Well,
you're in trouble.
Charlie Brooks has two runners, but five there is Scott and Banks. Now, he pulled up last time at Haydock, but then it was a bog. He wants this ground. He'd set up a whole sequence of wins before, but at these weights, they don't favour him, Scu.
No, I spoke to Tim Eastie before. He fancies this horse. He says this horse likes this type of track, galloping track. Obviously, maybe go a bit quick for him early on, but you put your finger on it, the ground will suit him. He's a real dour old stayer, doesn't he? Really jumps and gallops.
Absolutely. Well, another one that didn't used to jump well there in the diamonds, Richard Dunwoody on board Unguided Missile, but he's a very good horse. He's only an 8-year-old, got a big future, this horse, and we've seen him a lot this year, Scu. He just gave best to Mamure at Cheltenham, but he didn't lose anything in defeat.
He's got very good form. I'm just beating Rough Quest at Ascot, making those terrible mistakes, and a Rough Quest came off a straight line, but still, that's very, very good form. You could see him growing up to be a Gold Cup horse, or good enough to be placed in the Gold Cup at any rate.
Yes, now it's easy to forget horses. There in the stars of Jenny Mould is Barton Bank with Tony McCoy on board. Tony McCoy galloping away with a Jockeys Championship. 4-1 from 7-2. I mean, on his best form, he is a top-class chaser. But, Scu, he just has lost his way a bit.
Ginny Elliott's been schooling this horse this year, and he seems to have been jumping very well for it. He came over backwards as a young horse and crushed his withers, and that they often think that's why he won't shorten up at a fence. But he is a very good horse. I thought he's probably the best galloper of his type in the country at the moment, if he would just pick his feet up at the fences.
And some money for Couldn't Be Better now, 9-4 from 5-2, and strength 2 for Unguided Missile, 5-1 into 7-2 from this morning. Barton Bank and Scott and Banks both out to 9-2. Egypt Mill Prince 15-2, and Black Humour is back at 14-1.
Right, sort yourselves out, jockeys, please.
Well, it sounds like they're calling them in. There's the colours of Lady Lloyd Webber, Black Humour, but Egypt Mill Prince is the one that's been heavily backed, and he looked brilliant in the paddock.
19 fences to be jumped in this Martell Cup, and Scott and Banks goes straight into the lead. Scott and Banks, the leader at the first, from Egypt Mill Prince on the far side, Black Humour right up with them, Couldn't Be Better just in behind with Barton Bank, an Unguided Missile, and coming to the first of the ditches now, Scott and Banks, Egypt Mill Prince, Barton Bank, In fourth was Black Humor, an unguided missile and couldn't be better. Coming to the third in the Martel Cup, 27,700 the winning owner picks up, and Scotton Banks the leader from Barton Bank. Four and a four there, Black Humor. And Black Humor fell very heavily, the old horse there, the 12-year-old. And Jamie Osborne still to rise. The horse is up on his feet all right. Scotton Banks, the leader from Barton Bank, as they go over the far side. And still Jamie Osborne being attended on the ground as Scotton Banks leads them down the far side from Barton Bank. Egypt Mill Prince, unguided missile, and couldn't be better. The back marker of what are now a quintet at the fourth. Scotton Banks from Barton Bank. Then Egypt Mill Prince, who jumped it beautifully. Unguided missile, and finally couldn't be better. Number five. Scotton Banks. Barton Bank just a little bit hesitant at that one. Coming to the second of the ditches now. Jamie Osborne up all right. Jamie Osborne up. He looks a bit groggy, but he's on his feet. Barton Banks on the inside. Barton Bank on the inside of Scotton Banks as they come to the seventh. An applause there you may have heard in the background for Jamie Osborne as he got to his feet, but he looks considerably shaken after that very, very heavy fall on the old horse Black Humor, who appeared unscathed mercifully. So Scotton Banks still the leader as they race towards the eighth of the 19 fences from Barton Bank and Egypt Mill Prince. And a spectacular jump by Barton Bank on the inside of Scotton Banks there took him into the lead. Barton Bank from Scotton Banks, very little between the two. Then comes Egypt Mill Prince, unguided missile, and couldn't be better. Another plain fence, number nine. Scotton and Barton together. Egypt Mill Prince, unguided missile, and couldn't be better. Number 10 is the third of the ditches. Scotton Banks and Barton Bank. Barton Bank just the leader from Scotton Banks. Going strongly in behind him, Egypt Mill Prince, then unguided missile, then couldn't be better. Racing down to the fence that'll be the last on the next circuit. Barton Bank and Scotton Banks together from Egypt Mill Prince, unguided missile, and couldn't be better. Now beginning to swing left-handed to make their way out over on the far side of this mild-may course, 3 miles and a furlong in all, this Martel Cup, and a full circuit ahead of them now as these two, Scotton Banks and Barton Bank, disputed. And couldn't be better has been pulled up. Couldn't be better has been pulled up. Four left in it now. So both Charlie Brooks horses out, Black Humor and couldn't be better. Number 12, Barton Bank and Scotton Banks. Back in third, unguided missile, and almost getting detached now is Egypt Mill Prince. Number 13, Barton Bank and Scotton Banks, unguided missile. Then Egypt Mill Prince. Egypt Mill Prince being chased along to keep in touch with them, but he's finding it hard to maintain contact over the fourth ditch. And there it was, Barton Bank from Scotton Banks, now under pressure. Unguided missile is traveling well in behind the two leaders. Five from home now, Barton Bank. Oh, he reached for that one. Unguided missile made a shocking blunder too, and Scotton Banks has gone back into second. Egypt Mill Prince is beginning to get a little bit closer to the others, but he's flat to the boards to do so, and it's Barton Bank from Scotton Banks, the two who've been the principals throughout, coming to the fourth from home now. Barton Bank from Scotton Banks, gap of about 6 lengths then to unguided missile. Another bad mistake by the leader, but he got away with it, Barton Bank. But as he did so, Scotton Banks comes back to join him again. They're racing into the home turn now with three fences left to jump in the Martell Cup, and it's Scottenbanks who's gone to the lead again. Scottenbanks under Lorcan and Wire as they come down to the third last from Barton Bank. The third last, and Scottenbanks lands in the lead, but Barton Bank is once again getting closer to him. Unguided Missile back in third, Egypt Mill Prince four. Coming down to the final ditch now, two from home. Scottenbanks on the far side. Bartenbanks landed in the lead though. It's Bartenbank on the near side. Scottenbanks producing a sprint though on the far side, goes back into the lead. Coming down to the final fence now, and it's the two that have matched each other throughout, with Scottenbanks the leader from Bartenbank by a good two lengths as he comes to the last. Scottenbanks under Lorcan Wire lands two lengths near a Bartenbank who makes a shocking blunder, only just gets away with it under Tony McCoy, and that has definitely handed the race to Scottenbanks, who wins it deservedly, races past the winning post, the winner. Second is Bartenbank, and third Unguided Missile, and fourth the only other finisher, Egypt Mill Prince. And so the result of a dramatic Martell Cup chase. First, number five, Scottenbanks, owned by Mr. I. Bray, trained by Tim Easterby and ridden by Lorcan Wire at 9-2. Second was number one, Barton Bank, owned by Mrs. Jenny Mole, trained by David Nicholson and ridden by Tony McCoy. And third, number six, Unguided Missile, owned by Mr. D. Harrison, trained by Gordon Richards and ridden by Richard Dunwoody, with fourth, number four, Egypt Mill Prince. Lorcan Wire had the misfortune to lose his intended Martell Grand National partner, Too Good to Be True, through an infection to the horse, wins the first chase of this great meeting.
And what a difference. Gallop and jumping had not helped Barton Bank. A lot of them he jumped well, but the ones he didn't, he sort of tripped over. And Tony McCoy comes right out the side. He's looking at the grass. Self-preservation takes over, and he gets back in the plate. But Scu, ground is the factor, and this horse goes on it, the winner.
Yes, we pointed that out before. Tim Easterby said that the ground with this horse, he's a good horse, isn't he? I could see him coming back for a Gold Cup or a National one day. Lovely horse. Very interesting race. About halfway down the back there, it looked all to play for until Unguided Missile made that terrible mistake. But he's a relentless galloper, this. He's by Lemos. I always used to think the Lemos horses wanted softer ground than this. Jumped up in the air a few times, but a great victory for Lorcan Wire. He's a very good rider, doesn't get the glories he deserves. He's following in the footsteps of a great jockey in John Joe O'Neill at Easterby's Yard, but a very fine rider in himself.
And these colours, well used to being in the winner's enclosure. Of course, Ian Bray's had a lot of good horses with Tim's father, Peter, for many years.
Yes, see, I remember riding one for him. Cy Brandian was a lovely horse, and he was placed in the Gold Cup. Behind there, Richard Dunwoody explaining how brilliant he was to stay on Unguided Missile. It was a lovely recovery, isn't it? What I love to see when those horses make those mistakes, he gives them a horse a chance before he starts rushing it again. He gave it a few strides to get away from the fence. Then he gave the horse a reminder it didn't come back onto the bridleway.
An amazing thing about this winner is that Tim and Peter Easterby say he's not a great worker at home. He isn't a sparkling horse, but this is where it matters.
That's right. There's so many of these steeplechasers, at any rate, don't need to be fast at home to win these races. They need to be tough and have a big heart, and that is definitely what he's got.
Yes, we can only assume, though I'm sure we'll get news that couldn't be better, probably burst a blood vessel because he stopped very quickly indeed and pulled up.
Yes, I think that's one of the reasons that Charlie sent him to Italy, was to try and get him over that problem. Charlie was very critical of himself, as I said beforehand, worrying whether he should have given him a race in the Gold Cup. He's proved himself right in the decision he made. He ran a great race in the Gold Cup, and it was just one too many today.
And those stars of Tony McCoy there, he's smiling now, but he wasn't smiling when it made a mistake. But this horse has come back to some very good form. On the whole, he jumped well. The ones that he misses, he certainly does miss.
Yes, I thought, to be fair to Barton Bank, that's as good as I've seen him jump. That cross fence, the fourth, fifth last, is very difficult fence to jump. I can't blame him too much for then. And again, going to the last, Tony McCoy has had to go up and ask him long. He's fighting a losing battle there. The only chance he's got is to come up long, and it wasn't there. And all credit to Ginny Lang, because I think this horse is jumping better than ever now, and it'll give the horse a lot of confidence from it. He won over here this trip as a novice, and he's met a very good horse here today. A very delighted Easterby crowd there. There's Tim's father, Tim's Peter Easterby, who's trained so many winners, and that's Ian Bray in the cap.
And as they said, only the initials on the license has changed. You know, it's still the same team back at home.
I think I love the way that the Easterby horses look. I remember when we used to look at Night Nurse and Sea Pigeon and those walking around the paddock. They looked so workmanlike in their manner. And this horse is similar to that. He's got another very good horse, I think. Simply Dashing looks a lovely horse. Similar type of workman type, nothing flash about them.
Yes, well, if they're relaxed at home and in the parade, they save it for the race course. If you've backed the winner, you want to know his price. It's as follows.
And another good result for the bookmakers here. Scott and Banks, the winner at 9-2. Second, Barton Bank at 9-2. And third, number six, Unguided Missile. All six ran. 7-2 Unguided Missile. The totes there win £5.10. Places £3.20, £2.10. The dual forecast, £14.20. And the straight forecast there, £21.85.
Well, well done, Tim Easterby. What a great start to his career. Big winner at Liverpool. And Norman, great for Tim, but not such a great race for Charlie Brooks.
No, obviously the ground was probably a little bit quick. He won in the Hennessy and heavy ground. I spoke to Lorcan Weir before the race. He told me the horse was flying, so he's a better judge than I am.
There's no good telling us that now. But Black Humour was the first to go. Charlie Brooks is other runner, of course. Jamie Osborne, not a good day for him so far. He tends to make mistakes, and well, he's made.
Yes, you can see Jamie Osborne just squeezing him up for a long one. He put down straight into the fence, and his tendency always in the past to go a little bit left, and I think that's really what happened. He decided to go left, and there just wasn't room. And horrible fall for Jamie. Hope he's okay.
That was a stinker. Couldn't be better. Was pulled up, and when they came to the fourth last, Tony McCoy asking, as Richard said, all the time, and getting, he got one or two great jumps out of Barton Bank.
Yes, he really did, all the way around this horse. He never really travelled today, Barton Bank. He was just off the ride all the way, and Tony, I thought, gave him a tremendous ride. He really did jump from fence to fence. And at this stage, when Scott and Banks goes on, you think there's no chance of Barton Bank getting to him. But Tony McCoy, you can see why he's going to be champion jockey. He really fired him in here and got a great jump and got back up sides. And they're racing now towards the open ditch, and he's done basically the same thing. He's fired him in, and he's put the gun to his head.
Well, this was his last chance, and he jumps incredibly. It comes out of it a length ahead of Scott and Bank. A terrific bit of riding that, but the Easterby horse had the resources.
Yes, like Scu said earlier, I think really that Scott and Banks could turn into be anything. It's a great performance. He kept galloping, and he was up there, you know, races between the two from the word go.
And now Barton Banks tired.
Tired and just put down into it, but you have to give the horse his credit. He did get over the fence quite well with his front end. And, you know, he was tired at that stage, which was a good run.
Well, well done, Tim Easterby. Well, it's just 5 months now since Ginger McCain said goodbye to his best friend of all time, the great Red Rum, for the last time. The best horse ever round Aintree. Well, some years ago, Ginger arranged for him to be buried at Aintree, which he was last October. And today, Ginger unveiled the gravestone, the headstone, to commemorate the old horse. It's in the shadow of the winning post, and what a lot of happy memories we have of him. Thank you.
It's a furlong to run now. 200 yards now for Crisp, and Red Rum still closing on him, and Crisp is getting very tired. And Red Rum is hunting after him. Red Rum is the one that's finishing the strongest. He's going to get up. Red Rum is going to win the National. And at the line, Red Rum has just snatched it from Crisp, and Red Rum is the winner. And it looks as though Red Rum's only got a jump in, but remember, he was deprived of it on the flat last year, or rather, he deprived the winner of it last year, and now he's jumped into the lead, and it's Red Rum, and this great local crowd giving him a tremendous ovation, and racing up towards the line, and Red Rum getting the ovation of his career, and the crowd veteran acknowledging the cheers of the crowd as he comes to the line, the winner of the National.
It doesn't need a jockey to ride a horse like that, just needs someone to sit on. He's a great horse.
Yeah.
He's a great horse.
The horse's part and Tommy's part. Absolutely. Never in doubt the way I saw it.
How do you do it and how does he do it?
I don't. He's a very, very exceptional horse. There's no ifs and buts about it.
I don't know what you say to Red Rum. Do you talk to him, whistle to him, give him a shout?
I don't know what to say to him. Frank, he's much more intelligent than I am. So what I could say to him wouldn't, I think he can hear, he's pricking his lugs up. I think he hears something different. He said, I've met that fella before someplace.
Red Rum, truly a horse that we'll never forget. And Ginger McCain will be paying his own personal tribute to the great horse in the minutes leading up to the Martel Grand National on Saturday. Well, there'll be 28 jockeys in that field, and amongst them, Jackie, Marcus Armitage and Carl Llewellyn there. We'll be back with the McGowan Novices Chase and BBC One. For now, it's goodbye on two.
In a year when this man dreams of one
the champ, and Cigar goes on to win the Dubai World Cup, second in Soul of the Manor, a long gap to Le Carrier third, and fourth is Pentire. Well, there he is, the American champ, Cigar. He's done it again, the winner of the Breeders' Cup Classic, and comes out now to win the Dubai World Cup, the inaugural running, and what a race it was, right down to the wire. And on the near side, Cigar ahead in front now, now a neck, as he answers every challenge in the run to the line. Soul of the Matter was very determined, but Cigar was just too good and too classy. A long gap then to Le Carrier, but it was an American 1-2-3, and Cigar, the champion, has gone on to score here in quite convincing style.
So Cigar, at English prices, returned the even money favorite, now winning his second most valuable race in the world. Second was number four, Soul of the Matter, 20-1. Third, number two, La Carrière. So a 1-2-3 for America, La Carrière, 14-1. And afterwards, Sheikh Mohammed spoke to Bill Smith.
Well, Shane Mohammed, we've had the first running of the Dubai World Cup. It was your pipe dream and it's turned into reality. How do you feel about it now?
Oh, I very, very pleased and really honored to have this race here and to have these fantastic horses from all over the world to come and compete here for the championship.
Your idea, sir, was to have this world championship in Dubai. You've had a race that was worthy of a world champion. The horse Cigar, what a marvelous race he's run.
Oh, I think he's a great horse. I mean, doesn't matter if somebody said he's a world champion and he's staying at home. It is not, you know. He has to come here and prove himself. And I think any horse come and meet the top horse of the world is the top horse of the world.
Bill, how worried were you before the race?
Well, I wasn't actually worried. I think I was. There was a lot of anticipation, and we were very, very anxious to get to the race and get it over with.
And what did you think of the result?
Well, I saw that my horse had to battle today. A horse ran up and looked him in the eye, and he showed a lot of courage to hold that horse off and win. We've overcome some hurdles along the way. We missed some training days since his last race, and felt that maybe we weren't 110% today, but the horse just proved that he had an extra special effort within him, and he brought it out on the racetrack and showed us and everybody how good he really is.
And what's his immediate program now, Bill?
Getting back to America safe and sound and rest him up a little bit and look down the road to the middle of the season and try to start over.
And where do you think he'll be next March?
Well, hopefully he's safe and sound in the breeding shed. I would imagine that he's going to be retired after this year. However, we'll see how things go as the year goes along.
Pentiles ran a terrific race to be fourth, Jeff. Were you pleased with him?
Very pleased indeed. Very pleased.
And what did Michael say when he got off?
Well, he said that he was going so well coming into the straight, he thought he was really going to be up there with him, but he just the sound's a little bit deep tonight, and he just tired that little bit, but he's run a hell of a race.
And what will his program be in England now?
Well, I'll just give him a little break now. I may bring him to Ascot, but I might just wait for the Eclipse and the King George.
And this is the first running of the Dubai World Cup. What did you think of the occasion?
Absolutely fantastic.
So if you might be back again then, all being well.
If I've still got him or a horse as good as him, yes.
From the very greatest flat race we've seen, sir, to the jumping race on Saturday, the Grand National, any fancies for that?
Well, I think that's a great race, really, and a lot of competition in it. I think, you know, sort of maybe one horse is a class horse, which is a rough quest. I think he's a class horse, and he might do it. I don't know.
Any chance of you having a runner in the Grand National any time, sir?
If we have a runner in that race, I hope one day, maybe in a few years, might train one from Dubai and go for that big race.
Well, that is something to make you shake in your boots. What a wonderful horse that Cigar is. I mean, the only sad thing is, of course, there'll never be any little Cigars because he's a gelding, but he is a champion, isn't he?
He is an amazing horse, you know, to win, what is it, 14 races now in the trot. It's amazing. And he looked beat yesterday and battled back. He's as tough as nails. He really is a true champion.
Norman, a bad day for poor Jamie Osborne. He's broken his collarbone now. He'll be gutted.
He will, but it'll ease the blow a little that Los Dragones is out at the National. But it just shows you what can happen in a couple of hours. Los Dragones is out, Jamie Osborne's out. But the racing will carry on.
Yeah. Right back to the real world now. We move on to the McGull Novices Chase, the Sandham and McGull Novices Chase. Runners and riders for that from Peter.
And number one is Ask Tom, with luckless Jamie Osborne being replaced by Peter Niven. Two is Cable Beach, Richard Dunwoody. Four, Cumbrian Challenge, Lorcan Noir. Five, Gambling Dock, written by Trevor Horgan, another challenger from Ireland like Cable Beach. Six is Lord Dorset, written by Tony McCoy. Seven is Manhattan Castle, the third challenger from Ireland, written by Frank Woods. Eight is Namuro, written by Paul Holly. Nine, Pemberley Place, written by Carl Llewellyn. Ten, Senor El Betruti, written by Graham Bradley. And 11 is Sublime Fellow, written by Mick Fitzgerald. Those are the runners. Here's how they bet.
And as expected, Manhattan Castle is the favourite, but he's drifting here on the course from 5-2 out to 3-1. Cable Beach 2, Friendless 7-2 out to 9-2. Senor El Betruti is 7-6. along with Lord Dorset 7-1 from 6-1. Gambling Dock 15-2 from 6. Cumbrian Challenge 8-9 back to 8 again. Ask Tom Easy to back there 13-2 out to 9-1. Sublime Fellow 14 from 12. And the outsiders in Muro and Pemberley Place both 25-1.
Yes, the horse we're trying to look at is number 7 there in the mainly green colours. That's Manhattan Castle. I was in a hotel just outside Cheltenham the night before the Arkle, and Arthur Moore told most of the people there that he thought this would win, and unluckily for him that the horse whipped round at start and unseated Francis Woods. But I know there's a few of the hotel contingent here today to try and get their money back. He's a very, very good horse, and I think he's the one that they all have to beat. 11-4 favourite from 3-1.
This'll be fast, novice chase, 2 miles here, won last year by Morsley and Norman Williamson, who's sitting here with us. But this is the second Irish horse, and he wants good ground. Trained by Michael Cunningham, who had a winner here a few years ago, 20 years ago, Winds of Time, ridden by the late John Harty. Biggest gamble I'd seen in years. He was backed from 20s to 2s. You can see underneath his chin, it's a pair of ladies' tights sticking out or a dirty bandage. Well, that is how they tie horses' tongues down now. It helps them breathe. It stops the tongue, which is a huge thing on a horse, from going back to the back of the throat and stopping them breathing. You can't breathe, you can't gallop. But this horse must have good ground. He's in with a big chance despite him drifting to 5-1. But ground is the key. He jumps well enough, and his form is good enough, and he's got Woody on board.
Yes, as you should say, he's bound to go good gallop. But this horse that comes, horse we're looking now, number 10 there is number 6 there is Ask Tom, the Lord Dorset, the mount of Tony McCoy. This horse will benefit from coming from behind, and say Cable Beach going off well in front will suit this horse. We've seen this horse win at Ascot, held right up, and came with a late run, and Tony McCoy's the man to do it. 15-2 from 7-1.
No, you've got, well, 3 parts of a minute.
Well, the grey horse in the race, there is Senor El Batruti, trained by Susan Knott for her husband, Gerard. They've done very well with their small string this year, and this horse is an exceptional jumper on good ground, which he's got today. He can bowl along, and I love the way Skew that he becomes airborne. He's bowled, and Brad's the man for him.
Yes, I just wonder if the track's a bit quick for him here, because round Sandown and places, Brad can go out and dominate. With Cable Beach in front, he won't be able to dominate today. You see Richard already lining up there on the inside, determined to make it. Brad upsides with him, and Francis Woods on Manhattan Castle, making sure he get a good start today. But Peter will tell us about it.
Just Pimbley Place and Sublime Feather to come in and join the others. They're taking a turn now.
Right, Johnny does out, jockeys, please.
Fierce pace in this.
Don't get on top of this.
And McGill,
wait,
chase.
Wait, I've got one out the back.
Pimbley Place again, holding
no,
him up.
No, no. Llewellyn, take a turn.
Several appeals. Oh, Llewellyn taking a turn on Pimbley Place. Manhattan Castle got to get in, and that's it. And Cable Beach jumps straight into the lead. Cable Beach, Pimbley Place, very reluctant to race. Manhattan Castle is right up with the lead, so is Sublime Fellow, as they come to the first. And, oh, we lost Sublime Fellow at that one, and Cable Beach has opened up a lead immediately of about 5 to 6 lengths over Manhattan Castle, as they race now towards the second with Sublime Fellow, the faller, and Pimbley Place has refused at that one, and Cable Beach is the leader from Manhattan Castle, a 1-2 for Ireland at the moment, with Ask Tom coming next. Just in behind them, Lord Dorset, then Signor El Batruti, and then Cumbrian Challenge and General Dock, and finally Namuro. And that was the first of the ditches. Coming to the fence now, that'll be the last after another circuit. And Cable Beach, who ran himself out in Cheltenham in the Arkle with about a 5-length advantage here from Ask Tom and Lord Dorset and Manhattan Castle, who's dropped back to fourth. General Dock nearly went there but got away with it. Cumbrian Challenge is next, followed by Senor El Batruti. He usually leads him, Senor El Batruti, but he can't go the pace at the moment. And Nemiro is the back marker, and Cable Beach goes out into the country under Richard Dunwoody. the leader by about three lengths from Ars Tom in second, and then comes Lord Dorset and Manhattan Castle, quite a close four. Little gap then to General Dock and Cumbrian Challenger, Senor Elbertruti and Nemiro over on the far side. And Cable Beach under Richard Dunwoody still making it from Ask Tom and Lord Dorset and Manhattan Castle. These four somewhere ahead now of General Dock. Cable Beach over that one. From Ask Tom, Lord Dorset, Manhattan Castle, General Dock. Gambling Dock, I should say. Over the six, and there Ask Tom headed Cable Beach. Cable Beach on the inside of Ask Tom. Then Lord Dorset, the second of the three ditches. Cable Beach back there on terms, in fact, jumps it in the lead from Ars Tom. Then come Manhattan Castle and Lord Dorset, and then Gambling Dock. Over the eighth, Cable Beach, Ars Tom, Lord Dorset, Manhattan Castle, Gambling Dock. And as they race round this turn, it's Cable Beach back in the lead now. From Ars Tom in second, Lord Dorset third, Manhattan Castle being chased along in four, Gambling Dock in five, and these long, long way clear of the remainder as they come to the next. Oh, Cable Beach, a bad one there. And Ars Tom went back into the lead again. Ars Tom from the stable that's going to be missing in the National, Lord Stragoni. Ask Tom for Tom Tate in the lead from Cable Beach. Lord Dorset coming there on the outside as they come down now towards the third last in the Sandyman McGow. Cable Beach in the center makes a bad mistake, and Lord Tom's back with the advantage, but Lord Dorset takes it up now as they come to the final ditch. At the final ditch, Lord Dorset from Ask Tom. Lord Dorset on the near side, Ask Tom. Lord Dorset's nearly gone there. Ask Tom has got the advantage again. And Ask Tom is wavering off a true line, but he still has a clear advantage. Manhattan Castle is finishing like a train, but he's got a lot to do. Coming to the final fence now and losing concentration in the lead. This Ask Tom, but looks as though he's only going to jump it. Ask Tom, he jumps it well. Ask Tom, and jumping it second is Lord Dorset, and third, Cable Beach, the longtime leader. Four is Manhattan Castle, and as they race up towards the line, Ask Tom wins the Sandyman McGull Novices Chase. Second is Lord Dorset, and third is Cable Beach, and fourth is Manhattan Castle. Fifth was Gambling Dock, and they're the only ones to finish, because pulled up were Senor Elbertruti, Pimberley Place, and Cumbrian Challenge. And so the result. First, number one, Ask Tom, owned by Mr. B.T. Stuart Brown, trained by Tom Tate and ridden by Peter Niven in place of the luckless Jamie Osborne, who broke his collarbone in the previous race. And second was number six, Lord Dorset, owned by Mr. John Hogg, trained by Alistair Charlton and ridden by Tony McCoy. And third was number two, Cable Beach, owned by Mr. Herb Stanley, trained by Michael Cunningham in Ireland and ridden by Richard Dunwoody, with fourth, number seven, Manhattan Castle. Ask Tom, the 10-1 winner of the Sandyman McGull Novices Chase.
It had been a real gallop early on, and the longtime leader Cable Beach didn't jump when he came off the bridle. The last three made mistakes, but this horse jumped impeccably. I didn't think initially he'd be fast enough for this skew, but in the end, stamina has won the day.
Yeah, the other thing that's interesting, Peter was pointing out that he was running around going to the last, and very often when the horses do that, they will have a look at the fence and allow you to drive them into a fence, and Peter has been able to do that on Ask Tom here, and he's really jumped the last well. He's not doing a lot now. You can see his old ears twitching along and just wondering what he's doing in front with the roar of the crowd. But a very, very good victory. Sad for Jamie Osborne, but a nice tonic for Peter Niven.
And for Thomas Tate, look how far the saddle's gone back. He's got a breast girth on, but in actual fact, he needed it because it had almost gone back over, you know, too far.
Yes, at this time of year, the horses are beginning to run up a little bit light. They've been in the training a long time, and the tack will go back a little bit.
Brian Stuart Brown owns this, of course. Large Action was his big hope for this season. That one sadly sidelined, but racing is a great game for ups and downs. You never know when it's going to come back and really lift you, and this has done it for him. And for Thomas Tate, how disappointed he must have been to withdraw Lo Stragoni from the National this morning, and here he wins the Sandyman McGull, which is worth 23,000 to the winner. But a big horse this, Scu, and stays further than the 2 miles.
Yes, you pointed out that he's a relentless galloper, and he is the sort of horse that could go on. He's by Strong Gale. We've seen stayers by Strong Gale. Also, that I've seen horses that I would swear would go on and stay further by Strong Gale, and that's as far as they get. But he, as is the type of horse that Strong Gale gets, he's a beautiful stamp of a chaser, isn't he?
Well, Niv has been riding for a good many years now, but you saw when they pulled up how he leant across and congratulated by Richard Dunwoody. I mean, it means so much. Winners here count for 10.
You could see it in the last race when Lork and Wire were exactly the same. An old professional, knows all about the game, yet he's still delighted to ride a winner here. And it's great to see.
Isn't it good to show emotion? Because that's what it's all about. It's still a sport. There in the fluffy hat behind is Monica Dickinson, who, of course, was a great trainer in her own right and is the mother-in-law of Thomas Tate here. So no doubt he gets some guidance from that direction.
Yes, he must be very, very pleased. Yes, smiling broadly in the back. She's just having a chat to Thomas now in the background.
So, as the saddle gets off, David Niven, a quick word goes in to weigh in, make sure he's the right weight. We'll catch up with the starting prices.
And round three to the bookmakers. Ask Tom, the winner here, at 10-1. Second number six, Lord Dorset, 7-1. And third number two, Cable Beach, at 11-2. And the totes there win £10, places £2.50, £2, and £2.20. The dual forecast, £23.10. And the straight forecast, £69.91.
Yes, this is a marvellous moment, just making sure you've got the right weight. Things do drop off, Scu.
You were paying him a great compliment earlier on. You were calling him David Niven. It's Peter.
Yes. Well, David Niven would, I'm sure, be very pleased to be here today. But isn't that marvellous? You know, that smile tells it all. Niv has done it.
Yeah, with me, Thomas Tate. We're looking nervously over our shoulders at Arthur Tom's hind legs. We're hoping to move him away. But it's been a wretched 24 hours for you with the news of Los Tagone.
A wretched 24 hours, yes. And, well, what compensation? What compensation?
But you've always thought a lot of this fellow.
Yes, yes, always, yes. It's a better horse than the other. Yes, shouldn't say that, but it's a 2 mile horse, anyway.
He's a fine big horse. We're seeing a very large view of him. Pull him forward.
Right.
We're still alive. Now, tell us about him.
I trust him a lot, but not that much.
This is a horse that ran very well in his one novice chase last season and fell. And you've been very patient, and now you're reaping the rewards.
But you've got to be patient. There aren't many got enough worth being patient for, you know. And he's always been one. I mean, he ran in 1 point in Ireland, and you know who was second? Sunny Bay.
Wow.
You know.
He won so well on Saturday. Mm. Tell me, there was one hiccup in this horse, that was last time at Cheltenham. What went wrong there?
Well, he'd had the virus, just like Los Tagone, a month beforehand, and he basically was over it, but he was post-viral, and they always take a run, and they're just a lack of edge, you know.
Thomas, we've got Peter Niven behind you.
Bring in Peter.
Gentlemen, I was going to ask what happened last time at Cheltenham. You were explaining that the horse perhaps wasn't quite right, but he certainly was a different horse today,
yeah,
Peter.
And the ground has benefited him a hell of a lot today. Obviously, the tackier ground at Cheltenham, he's bounced off this better ground here.
And going to two out, Tony McCoy was delivering a pretty serious challenge on Lord Dorset. Did you see what he did at the fence?
I caught in the side of my eye, but I always thought it would have suited me to have a bit of company down the last, actually, so I wasn't that fussed. And I know Lord Dorset, I've ridden him before, and he wouldn't like it to be in front there anyway.
But certainly you galloped on from the last, your horse was still pretty tired, it seemed.
He's tying up, but as I say, I could have done with a bit of company. It's a long run from the second last to the last. Company would have been okay.
Peter, everybody's looking forward to the National. What is the ground now in your view?
It's good ground. It might dry out. Yeah, it's still this wind blowing across it, and it does dry very quick round here. But at the moment, it's good ground.
And if you had the chance, what would you like to ride in the race?
I think I'd probably go for Son of War, like the look of him. I think it would definitely come out the top nine in the weights anyway, so there we go.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, congratulations to Thomas Tate. It certainly is a game of ups and downs, and for no one more than Jamie Osborne, at least he's had his three bad bits of news today. He's lost his ride in the Grand National on Los Tagone. He's broken his collarbone, as you can see, his left collarbone, in a crashing fall from Black Humour, and as a result of that, he's missed winning a £35,000 race on Ask Tom. But he'll be delighted for both the trainer and
for Peter Nevin, of course. Well, it was a race of drama both at the end and at the start, and particularly at the beginning. And this isn't the first time that Pemberley Place has shown his dislike for Liverpool. He wouldn't jump off. Well, he did eventually, but as you can see, 10 or 12 lengths behind the rest of the field, and not very willing at all. And when they came to the first fence, well, he was still well off them. But the horse right up there with the pace was Sublime Fellow in the yellow colours with the brown hoop sleeves, and this happened.
Yes, Mick Fitzgerald there, they're going a hell of a gallop, Cable Beach. Anything lying up with him going to the first is going very quick, and just got in too close, and down he went.
Well, they came to three out, and it really was a race of changing fortunes, because Cable Beach in the yellow had led it but kept on giving it away with jumps like that. Ask Tom had been tracking him for a mile now, and coming on the outside here, Lord Dorset and Tony McCoy going best of all.
Yes, Tony McCoy looked to do everything perfect, just sat behind the pair, and I'm going here to the open ditch. It looked like he was going to go ahead and win his race, and here he goes for a long one, as he did on Barton Bank, and down he put it. Very, very lucky to stay on, and again, Richard behind. Just see him squeezing up hands and legs. Horse just goes and puts another stride in, and into the ditch he goes. The horse really did well to stay up, and so did Tony McCoy to stay on him.
Well, that left Tom 4 or 5 lengths clear, but it's a long run between the last two now, isn't it?
Hell of a long run. This horse, as Scu said earlier, he's looking all over the place. I'm sure he could have done with a bit of company all the way up to the last fence. But always, I think a horse pricking his ears like this just might have a little bit left in the tank. And as he showed at the last fence, he threw a great jump at the last. But the other horses behind, Manhattan Castle, he was off the ride a long way out. Cable Beach, as we feared earlier, mightn't quite get the trip. And Lord Dorset, well, the mistake has probably cost him the race, but can't take anything away from the winner. Peter Niven saw a perfect stride, and all the way to the line, it's all P. Niven, it's his lucky day.
Not my lucky day. I backed him at Cheltenham. He came back with this virus and this stuff in his throat. But today he's really done the business. Lovely big fine horse, isn't it?
He's a horse could improve, and I'm sure he'll go ahead and get a trip. He'll worry a bit with strong gales, but I'm sure this fellow will. And he might even in another 12 months go with a little bit of cut in the ground.
Norman, thank you. Some very sad news on the first day of the Grand National Meeting, with the death of the highly respected Brigadier Roscoe Harvey. Brigadier Harvey was a steward secretary for 20-odd years after the war. He was one of the most popular men ever in racing administration. Since then, he's retired to Gloucestershire, and he's had horses in training with David Nicholson, but up until last year, he was a regular race-goer and was always greeted warmly by many friends, amongst whom was Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother. Well, Peter Scudamore had the pleasure and privilege of riding for the Brigadier. Peter, a lovable man.
Yes, I think he was one of the most respected figures in racing. As a steward secretary, you could, I was told, it was before my time, that you could go and have a word with him if something went wrong, things were going wrong. He would come and have a word with you instead of hauling you straight in. He was a very, very respected man, and under him, things didn't go wrong. And he was a great friend of Sir Gordon Richards as well.
And he went on enjoying his racing right to the death.
Yes, he had some wonderful horses in training with David, and I think Nicholson would say the same, that he respected him as much as any man that I come across with him. At any rate, we had some great times together. I used to go into the paddock sometimes, and David would tell me to drop it in fourth or fifth or something, and the Brigadier would take me to one side and say, don't take any notice of him, jump it off fourth, first or second, go like hell.
Peter, thank you. Brigadier Roscoe Harvey has died at the age of 95. Well, now we look forward again to Saturday's Martel Grand National, and for the first time ever, the great race will be started by a former professional jockey. Jerry Scott is the new man in the hot seat. He was the man who won the National 36 years ago on Merriman the Second.
Beaches Brook for the second time. The 3 leaders over, and a casualty or two. Apparently nothing serious. The tremendous struggle between Badenloch and Merriman never let up. Jerry Scott's mount was running like a favourite, which is not the usual way of favourites in the Grand National. Merriman was building up a commanding lead, which Badenloch could not reduce. All Merriman had to do now was to stay on his feet, and the Grand National was his. He was safely over the last fence, going great guns on the run-in of 495 yards. By a good 15 lengths, Merriman the second won the Grand National. Badenloch second, Clear Profit third.
Well, Jerry, first of all, congratulations on your appointment. Looking back to that great day in 1960, the fences, well, they looked a lot more formidable then than they are now.
Oh, well, they're certainly different, there's no doubt about that. Yes, they were bigger and they were very straight up and down. They had no apron on, no line for speed, for horse. You know, they really had to be jumped and obviously possibly jumped slower than they are today.
Do you find that the horses generally go much faster nowadays than they did then?
I think the times of the races will tell you itself that they're obviously going faster than they were in our time. But as I say, I mean, horses in those days, the fences were bigger, straighter, I'm repeating myself, but it's just a fact, and they had to be jumped. I'm not saying that they happen to be jumped today, but racing today has speeded up in every aspect. The horses are a different style of horse.
And nowadays you wouldn't have been allowed to ride.
From my own point of view, no, I wouldn't. I broke my collarbone in two places at Doncaster on the Monday previous, that sort of 12 days before. And I was very, very lucky, because in my day there was no medical record book, which I'm a great believer on today, but I think with collarbones and things like that, they could let a little bit go. And I was very lucky, because riding for such a loyal governor as Captain Crump, he said to me, come and ride two in the hurdle races on the Friday, and if you're satisfied, we'll have you before three doctors after racing, because he said, it just shows the loyalty of the man, because he said, I've got to be loyal to the public, to the owner, and to me, which was fantastic in this game. And I went before three doctors on the Friday night, and two of them passed me fit, and the other one didn't. And the one that didn't was an orthopaedic surgeon. In actual fact, he was quite right. It was so.
Well, you sounded a lot less fit than Bill Williamson when he was docked off Roberto, but that's another story. Jerry, the starts at Cheltenham this year, they were widely criticised, rightly or wrongly, and the jockeys certainly didn't make life easy for Simon Morand. Now, are you planning to do things differently this week?
The way I'll start the races over this 3 days are exactly the same way as I've started all my life. Why I've been starting. The reason for me starting these races is not the fact that Simon's been stood down for it. He's standing back to make assessment of Cheltenham and Aintree, and it's his assessment, it's what I do for this meeting, to what the assessment comes up with.
But the problem at Cheltenham, and indeed it was the problem here at Aintree 3 years ago when we had that awful full start, was the fact that the jockeys were letting their horses get their heads over the tapes. Now, is this something you're going to try and avoid?
I'm going to talk to the jockey before the first race today, and I'll talk to them before the Grand National. Apart from that, I'm going to out here to start as I've always done.
You'll be talking to them before the National. What will you be saying to them?
I'll just ask them for cooperation. It's a team job. We've got to work together. I can't go anywhere without them, and they can't go anywhere without me.
If you foresee any problems on Saturday?
Hopefully not.
Jerry's got there, and we'll all drink to that. Well, the man that Jerry's replaced is, of course, the Jockey Club senior starter, Simon Morand, who started the last two Grand Nationals, and very successfully too. So why has he been replaced? That's a question for the Jockey Club's Director of Public Affairs, David Pipe. David, what exactly is going on?
Well, I think that the problems with starting the championship races has been getting worse and worse ever since about the mid-80s. And increasingly, jockeys have felt it's important to get fast away from the start. And I think that's borne out by Richard Dunwoody's remarks on The Life Today, when he was talking about the importance of the start and the race, however long it is. And because of the difficulties which we've been facing, after the 1993 start, which you showed there, trainers, jockeys, jockey club officials got together to look at all the procedures. And they came up with some changes and some options and some ideas. And we tried those. And it's been going not too badly, generally, but the championship races are still a problem, as people thought about Cheltenham, I believe, generally.
Well, Simon and Moran's on record as saying that he would like it to be an offence for jockeys to allow horses to get their heads over the tape, and that they should be fined. I mean, really, that's it, isn't it?
Can do that now. I mean, what we want to do now is for Simon to have a really good look at it again. I mean, I know it's only 3 years since we looked at it last time, but we'll do it again. And clearly you can't do that properly if you're actually involved in the mechanics of starting. So we've said to him, Simon, better for you to stand back for the good of racing as a whole, look at it and come up with your views. As far as penalising jockeys is concerned, that can happen now. If a jockey is tiresome at the start, then the starter can report him to the stewards, and if they agree, then he'll be fined, and that happens now. I think, as Jerry said, this is a team effort. It requires understanding on both sides, but if the starter says something's got to happen, then the jockeys have got to respect that.
Well, in a word, who's going to be starting next year's National? Is it going to be Jerry Scott or Simon Morant?
Not for me to say.
Right, David, thank you. Norman Williamson. Surely the answer is for jockeys to line up 10 yards behind the tapes and walk in. Why won't you do it?
Sounds a great idea, but it is very difficult to do. We saw it at Cheltenham. If you have 25, 30 runners and you're told be handy, if someone alongside you goes half a length up, you're going to go with them. I think it would be worth trying shavings a few yards from the tape just to keep them back from the tape.
They say they blow away.
Well, I don't think you could do anything there, but I don't think so. Keeping the horse's head off the tape is the big problem. But we've seen it the past 4 or 5 years, things are just getting more competitive.
Is it going to be all right on Saturday?
I would think so.
Thank you both. Right. Let's move on now to the first race of the meeting over the Grand National fences. It's the John Hughes Memorial Trophy Chase. Big field, Peter O'Sullivan names them.
Number one is All the Aces, written by Conor Edouard. Two, Old Bridge, written by Simon McNeil. Three, Master Boston, Lorcan Noir. Four, Go Universal, Graham Bradley. Five, Straight Talk, Tony McCoy. Six, Back Bar, Frank Woods. Seven, Iffy, written by David Walsh. Eight, Bardelaine, Brendan Powell, now replacing Jamie Osborne. Nine is James Pig, written by David Bridgewater. 10, Romany King, Mr. Marcus Armitage. 11, Taurine Prince, one of the seniors, 13 years old, written by the leading amateur, 22-year-old Jim Colotti, having his first visit to Aintree. 12 is Magoni Beach, £3 overweight for Jonathan Lauer. 13, Tudor Fable, £3 overweight for Mick Fitzgerald. 14, Bold Choice, £2 overweight for Jimmy Frost. 15, another grey, Sailor Jim, written by Chris Maud. 16, Give Us a Buck, another 13-year-old, Blinkered, written by Paul Holly. 17, Pim's Gunner, with Richard Dunwoody, putting up £4 overweight. 18 is Deep Decision, Robbie Supple. 19, Joe White, Paul Carberry. 20, Capridi Lad, written by Robert Bellamy. And 21 is Channel Pastime, with Guy Lewis, who probably be the youngest rider in the National on Saturday, rides Brackenfield, putting up £2 overweight this time.
Wide open betting. Here we are. We've got co-favourites of three, Taurine Prince, Old Bridge and Back Bar, all 7-1. Then it's 8-1, Tudor Fable and Go Universal. Iffy is 10-1 from 8. Master Boston is 10-1. Then they go 14-1, Straight Talk, Romany King, Sailor Jim, Pim's Gunner, and that's followed by 16-1 James Pig, 20 All the Aces, 20-1 Butter Lane, 25-1 Mugoni Beach, Give Us a Buck and Deep Decision. Then it's 33-1 Joe White, 40-1 Bold Choice and Capridi Lad, and 100-1 Channel Pastime.
So 7-1 the field, but here's a horse who jumps for fun. He's number 5, Straight Talk. He's a 14-1 shot, a really spectacular jumper of fences, perhaps almost too bold for Aintree, you might say. But he's a joy to watch, and he jumped quite beautifully at Ascot this year. He's a great jumper of ditches, and look at the way he pricks his ears here. And Norman, well, you'd love to ride this, wouldn't you? Look at that.
Yes, you would love to be on him here. That's an outstanding jump. It really is. And he did. He ran a super race that day. Just lost his form a little, but really, I think on his best of his form, and if he jumps well, he could have a great chance.
Well, he was in good form here. He won again at Sandown after that. And, well, if he's on song, then if he's not too brave, then... And Tony McCoy is just the man to ride him, because he's quite fearless. Well, he's got a chance today, but he'll provide an interesting point of the chances of Deep Bramble on Saturday, because for the past fortnight he's been his regular work companion. That's Straight Talk on the left, Deep Bramble on this side, so Paul Nichols will be keeping a very close eye on how this fellow runs today. Do you think he'll run all right, Norman?
Yes, I think so. Deep Bramble, he's inclined to miss one or two fences, Deep Bramble, so it'll be interesting to see him Saturday, but definitely this fellow will be appointed a Deep Bramble, and let's see how well their horses are.
Well, plenty of fancies here. And we now have a clear favourite in Henrietta Knight's runner, Tourine Prince, 13-2, 7-1, Old Bridge, 8-1, bar those two, as we join Richard and Skip.
Yes, there's a straight talk, just having a look at the fence there. I think what's very important about this race is the start here. There's a couple of horses that like to be right out up with the pace, and you've really got to jump out of the gate and get an important get your position. It's very, very important. There's a lot of runners in this race, makes it more difficult, and now with Beecher's not having its drop, a lot of horses try and go down the inner. And this is one there in the tartan colours, the red sleeve, Simon McNeil on Old Bridge, and this horse won at Cheltenham, and he was up there all the way, and I can see Simon McNeil trying to jump this horse right up with the pace there, so it'll be interesting to see if he can get out the gate quick.
Yes, he's ridden by Simon McNeil, who's been injured of late, but he's back riding today. Jonathan Powell spoke to him before he went out.
Simon, 2.5 weeks ago you had a dreadful fall, you dislocated your left shoulder. Here you are over the most daunting fences in the world. How is the shoulder?
It seems fine at the moment, actually. Adam Ogden's just come and whacked me on it and greeted me, and it stood up to that pretty well, actually.
No problem passing the doctor?
No, I had a ride at Huntingdon on Tuesday and had four yesterday, and it seems fine.
That's good news. What about Old Bridge, the horse you know well from the past? You won quite a few novice chases on him. He has fallen. Will he cope with these fences?
Yeah, you never know until you run a horse over these fences, but they're made very inviting now, and you'd be disappointed if he didn't jump, to be honest.
You've had a walk round this morning. How did you find the ground?
Ground's very good ground, you know, slightly live. There's plenty of grass on it, unlike many courses that we've seen recently.
Good luck to you.
Thanks very much.
Okay, well, there are plenty of others in with a chance, and there with the blue colours and the darker blue seams is Tourine Prince. Now he's getting on now, he's 13. He's 13-2 favourite from 7-1, but he loves jumping. He was second in this race last year. Jim Colotti, who rides him, is the find of the season. He's an amateur now, but he won't be for very long. He really does have a future as a professional jockey. Trained by Henrietta Knight, whose horses have maintained their form all season. And this one's last run really puts him in with a big squeak. He was third to Mamour and Rectory Garden at Ludlow. Now, basically, he's a soft ground horse, but his last win was on good ground at Kempton, and his last run was on good ground. So as he's getting older, perhaps he's handling it. This one has a real shout, and expect him to jump for fun. I saw him in the paddock, and Lord Vesty was looking at him, who, of course, is Henrietta Knight's brother-in-law, and he will give them a good run.
There is number six, the mount of Frankie Woods, who we saw on Manhattan Castle in the last race. He rides Wild Hyde in the National. This is a bit of a practice for him. It's a fine big stamp of a horse, isn't he? This, not a lot of experience over fences, still a novice, but another strong gale horse that looks really well in himself, and that so many of these strong gale horses jump really well.
And more money now for Tourine Prince, out to 7-1, back to 6-1, clear favourite. Old Bridge, Tudor Fable and Go Universal, 8-1, back bar drifting, 9s from 7s, Iffy 10s from 8s, Master Boston, 12s from 10s, 14-1, Romany King and Pim's Gunner, and it's 16-1, bar those.
Tudor Fable in at 8-1 in the red hat there. We saw this horse win at Newbury. It was pretty wet there. It said officially good to soft, but it was quite testing. He pulled up then in January. He'd had quite a rest to get himself back, and he'd won his previous race at Toaster, very stiff 2.5 miles a furlong there, but he does stay 2 miles for. This is an amazing race, 2.6, they go very, very fast, and I think, Skew, you need a horse that stays this and more in order to come good. He's 8-1 from sevens, Nicky Henderson's stable. I just wonder if it's soft enough for him.
There in the blue with the red epaulettes is number four, Go Universal, the mount of Graham Bradley, an artist in the saddle, and this horse could give us a real thrill. And Brad, I expect, he's a front-running sort. He's notched up a five-timer earlier in the season. He had a month layoff and then came back and was defeated, but another one that's going to be right up there, and there's going to be plenty of early pace.
Well, there's no doubt about that. They won't hang around here because they all want to get a good slot before they get to the third, which is, of course, the chair. There, number seven with the stars, David Walsh riding Iffy. He's had a tremendous season, this fellow, for Peter Bowen, the former point-to-point trainer from right down as far in the southwest of Wales as you can go, and he doesn't mind travelling his horses up to Sedgefield, Catterick, anywhere. Turned out in great fashion here. He really is a credit to Peter Bowen, and his last run was a good win at Sedgefield over 3 miles, 4 furlongs, so he'll stay all of this distance today.
Looking for straight talk. There he is. We've seen him already and where he jumps. I just, the one worry about this is that these fences, rather than being high, are very wide, and when you don't want horses standing off round here as far as his, your horse did it crisp and Aldeniti, but they're unusual in doing it. It's not a general good rule to have going around here.
No, well, I used to love riding in this race because it's a thrill. It gets you G'd up for the National in 2 days' time. There are three greys in this race. One of them is number one here, All the Aces. Very disappointing at Cheltenham, never ever going at any stage. But he stays. Whether he'll stay fast enough today, we'll see. He's owned by J.P. McManus, very famous owner, punter, bookmaker, and one of the nicest men that you could wish to meet. Well, he had a winner at Cheltenham. It's 20-1 from 16, so no McManus cash on All the Aces. Trained by Arthur Moore in Ireland.
There is number three, the mount of a winning jockey this afternoon, Lorcan Wire, trained by Bob Woodhouse up in York. And this horse is one of the sequences wins as well. He was a decent hurdler, and he's improving over fences. So, again, what is important here, Richard, is just getting up over those first three, isn't it? Just getting the horse to see the fences, not rushing. When they see that first fence a little bit, they'll go and rush it and sometimes over jump. And you still want to have your wits about you by the time you get to the third fence, which is the chair.
Yes, lovely grey horse. Quick check on the market. Taurine Prince at 6-1, still at the head of the market. 8's Old Bridge, he's drifted a bit. 9's Go Universal, Charlie Brooks' horse, lovely horse on this ground. Tudor Fable at 9-1, 10-1 bar. What an open race it is.
Yes, it is a very open race. And what this race tends to do is revive some of the old horses that have gone off a little bit in their form.
Yes, Bar Delane going around there, trotting. Brendan Powell's just got the ride here because Jamie Osborne's done his left collarbone in. No blinkers on this horse today. He's been blinkered the last three times that he ran. And Brendan Powell won a thrilling race here last year on Dublin Flyer in this event.
Again, that's really what Oliver's using, that horses use blinkers to cheer them up a bit. The fences around here in themselves would cheer them up. You said you enjoyed riding around here. I was worried riding around here when you've got a great national ride. And there's a man with a good national ride, number 9, David Bridgewater on James Pig. He rides on Court on Purr in the national. I think he's got a great chance of being placed. I spoke to Martin Pipe on the phone coming up here. Well done, Martin. He's watching at home. Well done on your earlier winner. And he says this horse will run well on the good ground. He's pulled up last time, but the ground was soft. He's a typical one of Martin Pipe's, that he's taken from little form to really improve to win a whole sequence of races. And Bridges, one who's determined to get up there down the inner. There isn't a braver jockey than David Bridgewater. And they're all lining up there, and Peter will tell you who gets out the gate first.
Get your head back, Fitzgerald.
Gary Scott asking them to keep their heads back.
Come on, get your head back on that tape. Take a turn, all of you.
Bergoni Beach just taking a turn behind him. Joe White turns to, so does Go Universal.
Take a turn.
All anxious to get a good break and a good sight of the first of the 18 Grand National fences that they jumped this time. These 21 runners, winners of 136 races between them. The possibility. Sailor Jim is a little bit behind the others.
I've got one turn the wrong way here.
James Pig turning. Go Universal trying to get in and join him. Bo Choice is facing the wrong way now. James Pig turns with Go Universal towards the right as we're looking at him now. They've gone right out behind. Bo Choice giving him a little bit of trouble too.
I didn't say take a turn. Come on up.
This is Go Universal and James Pig coming up to join the other 19 now.
You've got to find your position. Come on, get yourselves in.
You're not going to get a lot better than this. Go Universal can't get in on the inside anywhere. Jeremy will send him to the outer.
now, so we've got to go now.
Sailor Jim turns, that's the grey.
The horse is shitting himself.
The Universal, still trying to get in here.
Brad, get up here.
Go on, Bridget. I'll let me through in the middle.
Doreen Prince, 13-2, the favourite. It's lined up right towards the left. Going to get a very clear view.
Shit up, sir. Let him go.
No, sir.
Come on, take it on the other side, Brad.
My horse is shitting himself.
Come on, take it on the other side.
Yes, he's sending Go Universal the other side. There he goes. Now this could be it. Yes, they're away. And it's a cracking good break too. And as they race towards the first, Straight Talk is well up there. So is Iffy and Deep Decision also. And just in behind them, Bold Choice, as they come to the first of the 18 fences. Iffy landed in the lead there. And Iffy a faller. Iffy has gone at that, landed in the lead and fell. And Tudor Fable went at the first as well. And it's Capridi Lad who's taken it up now from Go Universal. Capridi Lad lands from Go Universal. Then Joe White over on the far side. Straight Talk's just in behind him, and then Barter Lane. And just in behind Barter Lane comes Pim's Gunner. They're coming down to the chair now with Capridi Lad, the leader from Go Universal on the inside. Joe White on the far side. Straight Talk right up with them. Just in behind them, Pim's Gunner and Deep Decision. Barter Lane. And they're all safely over the chair, coming down to the water now with Capridi Lad on the far side of Go Universal. They land together from Barter Lane in third and Straight Talk four. Just in behind them, Joe White and then Pim's Gunner. Then comes Old Bridge. Then on the inside, the grey, all the aces. Then Channel Pastime. Just in behind Channel Pastime, Deep Decision, Magoni Beach comes next, and behind Magoni Beach is Back Bar. They're racing now towards the Melling Road, and as they do so, it's Capridi Lad on the inside of Go Universal. Joe White is next, Straight Talk on the outside, and Barter Lane also well up there with them, and over to John Hanmer.
And they're coming towards fence number five, and Capridi Lad and Go Universal that they're leading from Joe White, Straight Talk, and Barter Lane. Pim's Gunner on the inside over the fifth now, leaders all over safely. The back markers just toiling over it, but coming to fence number six, Capridi Lad the leader from Go Universal, Straight Talk, and then just in behind them, Joe White. Old Bridge has taken a good position. Then comes Pim's Gunner, and they're followed by Channel Pastime coming to the open ditch. Fence number seven, Go Universal, just in the lead from Straight Talk, then Capridi Lad. They're all jumping it well, except for all the aces who's down, and going to the next, Go Universal, the leader from Capridi Lad, Straight Talk and Old Bridge, and over to Jim McGrath.
And Old Bridge has gone there, and so too has Pim's Gunner down as well, brought down as they head now towards fence number nine, and the leader, Go Universal, from Capridi Lad and Straight Talk just behind them, then follows Channel Pastime, jumping it in fourth, then Joe White the inside, further back is Magoni Beach, out wide, and then is Back Bar from Deep Decision. Sailor Jim in behind them as they come now towards Beaches, and it's Capridi Lad and Go Universal together. They match strides coming towards Beaches now from Straight Talk in third. Further back then on the inside, Joe White, Sailor Jim back in the field, dipped very badly on landing, and one of the tail enders at this stage, Romany King, coming to the Foynaven fence, and it's Go Universal and Capridi Lad together from Straight Talk, then Channel Pastime from Joe White. A gap to Magoni Beach, Deep Decision. Further back then is Back Bar from Sailor Jim, a couple of links then to Master Boston. They're followed back in the field by Give Us a Buck as they go to the canal turn, then James Pig from Barter Lane, and Go Universal jumped it well in the lead there. The tail enders here behind Barter Lane are Bold Choice with Romany King, and Tureen Prince is right out the back, absolute last, as they go to the Valentines now, and leading over it was Go Universal from Capridi Lad. Further back, Joe White from Straight Talk, as we rejoin John Hanmer.
They've got five to jump, and it's Go Universal from Capridi Lad, Straight Talk, Joe White, and Capridi Lad has gone at that one. That leaves Go Universal four lengths in front of Straight Talk, then Joe White, Magoni Beach moving up, then comes Channel Pastime over the last ditch, four out, and they're fairly well bunched with Go Universal leading from Straight Talk, Joe White, Magoni Beach, Master Boston, Channel Pastime, James Pig, then Deep Decision, Give Us a Buck, and then Back Bar and Sailor Jim as they jump three out. Go Universal not so far in front now. Go Universal by a couple of lengths from Straight Talk. as they race towards the Melling Road and over it now, and it's Go Universal from Rigoni Beach straight talk, and then comes Joe White, Channel Pastime Master Basque and Sailor Jim, and give us a back and over to Peter O'Sullivan.
Just two fences to jump now in the John Hughes Memorial. Is Go Universal on the near side as we see them on the right, Rigoni Beach towards the left, straight talk just in behind them. Joe White comes fourth, Go Universal under Graham Bradley, still the leader. From Rigoni Beach in second, Joe White under pressure, straight talk keeping on, and the two greys getting into the picture now are Master Boston and Sailor Jim. But it's Rigoni Beach and Go Universal together now, and Rigoni Beach on the near side, Go Universal on the far side. Channel Pastime is putting in quite a good run towards the far left of the picture, but as they come down to the final fence now, it's Go Universal and Rigoni Beach. These two still disputing it. They land in unison. Go Universal on the far side, Rigoni Beach on the near side. Straight Talk and Joe White come next, and they're being chased by Master Boston as they race towards the elbow. Go Universal on the far side, Rigoni Beach on the near side, and here comes Joe White to make it a threesome as they race into the closing stages. Go Universal being chased now by Joe White with the white face on the near side, but it's still Go Universal. But Joe White is beginning to get up. Joe White is getting up on the near side, and it's going to be a photo. Joe White may have just won it in a photo from Go Universal, with Rigoni Beach between horses. Straight Talk came behind them, and then Give Us a Buck and James Pig, and behind James Pig was Sailor Jim, and then Master Boston, and then Channel Pastime, and then Barter Lane, and behind Barter Lane was Back Bar, and then came Taurean Prince, the favorite, and finally Deep Decision. It's a photo at the end of the 1996 John Hughes Memorial Trophy, with Joe White just getting there on the near side, as you can see, under Paul Carberry. Joe White has just won it from Go Universal over on the far side, number four that is, and Rigoni Beach number 12. A tremendous climax this to the John Hughes Memorial Trophy. Joe White is the winner. He's announced the winner. Joe White, owned by Mr. Howard Johnson, trained by him, and written by Paul Carberry. Paul's 36th winner of the season, number 26 for Howard Johnson. 6 out of 62 for this 10-year-old Joe White. Second was number 4, Go Universal, owned by Universal Conference and Incentive Travel Limited, trained by Charlie Brooks and written by Graham Bradley. And third was number 12, Rigoni Beach, owned by Mr. Jim Ennis, trained by Martin Pipe and written by Jonathan Lower. And fourth was number 5, Straight Talk. Well, Go Universal and Graham Bradley must have thought they had it here. But all the time, Paul Carberry is finishing relentlessly on this Joe White. And officially, when he gets to the line, Joe White has got it by an official head. Joe White on the near side. One of the closest ever finishes, surely, at the end of a 2¾-mile chase. Here at Aintree, with a head and a neck, the official margins. And Paul now likely to ride 3 brownies in the National, one of the long odds outsiders on Saturday, following the withdrawal of his intended mount, Tartan Tyrant. But who's to say that he hasn't a chance on a long odds chance, because this was another shot for the punters, a 33-1 winner of the John Hughes Memorial over 18 of the Grand National fences. As many, as my colleague John de Marville just reminded me, many will remember Paul's father, Tommy Carberry, winning the National on Lescargot, who had Red Rum as his nearest victim when he won it in 1975, I think it was. And he, in fact,
was the last Irish winner, 21 years ago. Joe White by Tempero, Arafari Rose by Boreen. A lot of French blood in his pedigree. And the full starting prices on the John Hughes Memorial as follows.
And another blow for punters here down in the ring, number 19, Joe White, the winner at 33-1. Second, Go Universal at 9-1. Third, Mugoni Beach, 33-1. And fourth, Straight Talk at 16-1.
So what a race for the Topham Trophy as it was, the John Hughes Memorial as it is now, with Paul Carberry giving a terrific ride to Joe White, the horse, ironically, on whom Norman Williamson broke his leg at Sedgefield last October. Well, Paul, the beneficiary of that particular bit of good fortune, and what a season he's had in his first season riding full-time for in Great Britain. And Brad had such great hopes jumping the last there on the inside with Mugoni Beach. Breathing down his neck is Joe White, who was always in contention, and very close behind Tony McCoy on Straight Talk, who's run a terrific race, will have encouraged the connections of Deep Bramble. And halfway up the run-in, Brad still in front on the inside, but facing these terrific challenges from Jonathan Lower on Mugoni Beach, and widest of all, Paul Carberry on Howard Johnson's horse. And it's only in the last 50 yards that Joe White, this horse who's been so consistent since that unhappy day at Sedgefield, gets up to win the John Hughes by just a head from Graham Bradley on the game Go Universal, with a neck back in third place, Mugoni Beach, the Martin Pipe runner bred by Richard Pitman. So a really pulsating start to the Martel Grand National meeting. The ambulance sound in the background, but so far we've heard no details of any casualties in this John Hughes Memorial. The big news of the day at Liverpool, the withdrawal of Lo Stregoni, the second favourite from the Martel Grand National. He's found to have a strain of influenza. He had a temperature this morning. He's been pulled out of the race by his trainer, Thomas Tate, who then went on to proceed to win the big novice chase of the day, the McGowan Novices Chase, with his Cheltenham disappointment, Ask Tom. The going here at Liverpool, getting faster all the while, perfect ground on the chase course so far, but with two dry days ahead and a strong wind blowing over Aintree, it's going to get faster. So Joe White wins a thrilling John Hughes Memorial at 33-1. That's it on BBC One. We're back almost immediately on Two. At Aintree, where we've just seen a pulsating race for the John Hughes Memorial Trophy. And in case you've just joined us, here's a check on the result. The winner at 33-1 was Joe White, ridden by Paul Carberry, paid £52.40 for a win on the tote, £7.70 for a place. Second was number 4, Go Universal, at 9-1, £1.90 for a place on the tote. Third, number 12, Mugoni Beach, 33-1. And paying £8.70 for a place on the tote. And fourth, number 5, Straight Talk, 16-1, paying £4.10 for a place on the tote. And Jonathan Powell is talking to Paul Carberry.
Yes, Paul, the name of Carberry stands very high in the history of the Grand National. You must be so thrilled to have ridden the winner over these big fences.
Well, I'm pleased just to get around them for once. I keep falling at them. It's great to win as well. Brilliant. I didn't think he'd be quick enough to run under it, like to go to gallop in the race, but got a great start and he's always going well. Jumps very carefully, you can't ask him because he's put down, you just have to sit with him. He does everything great, like he knows how to mind himself. And just gave him a little breather after jumping the third last, came back on it well and stayed on well up the hill.
You still had a fair bit to do jumping the last. Go Universal went on again, he must have been 3 or 4 lengths down at the last fence pull.
I was, but it was after getting a good breather into him, and I knew well he'd stay well up the hill, he'd keep battling on, which he did in the end anyway.
Before you first rode here, did you talk to your dad about these big fences?
Yeah, he did it a long time, that's about 6 years ago. Didn't get too far then either, he just told me to sit still. I was only a young lad, didn't
you? How old were you, about 16 when you rode in the Fox Hunters?
Yeah, I was only 16.
And you weighed, what, about 7 stone?
Yeah, and the horse was carrying 13.
Well, on Saturday you ride a great outsider. I mean, he's about 50 to one shot, 3 brownies.
Yeah, he's the ground's after coming good for him as well. He loved the ground, great big staying horse, and he jumped brilliant. So it's all it takes, really. But like, he'll run a great race, I'm sure.
Good luck to you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
So, a race full of excitement. The fences certainly took their toll. Richard Pitman, Peter Scudamore and Norman Williamson, take us through the race, gentlemen.
Well, a fantastic gallop, as we thought, Skew, and this is the danger point. Everyone trying to get it. If he is the first to go in the stars, and he's bang up there in the fighting line. David Walsh asks for a big one there and looks if he gets it and just tumbles over on landing.
Classic first race fall, isn't it, Norman? He's jumped it well, but they're going a bit quick and his momentum has just carried him over.
Yes, as we've found in the past two seasons, this fence has been well found out as the tricky one, and he looked to jump the fence perfect and just tippled over on landing, and I hope they're okay.
Yes, Tudor Fable, the other one to go, but onto the ninth fence now with Go Universal really flying, and this is where the favourite now just jumping goes.
Yes, you can see he just got tucked in to the fence there. He was never going to get out of trouble, and there falling independently, I think, is Richard and Woody on Pim's Gunner.
Yes, Skew, that was Richard, and I hope Simon McNeil is all right. He's just back from a shoulder injury, and it looked as if he nearly brought down Pim's Gunner.
Yes, Robert Bellamy on this side here on Property Lad, giving this horse a fine ride, doesn't get a lot of rides himself, but this horse is really jumping for fun. Look at him going to stand off. But look at that.
Fascinating that Brad got to the front, because he was one of those early jockeys, couldn't get in the line, and yet in the end got a flyer.
Well, you and I were shouting at him when he was trying to go down the inner, get to the outer, you'll get out if you're good enough, and he did. Yeah, they're coming down to beaches, they're all beginning to stream out. As you said, it's not the fence that it once was, but it's still an obstacle that's formidable enough.
Yes, indeed, and you can see that they're noticeably drifting out to the right, Norman.
Just drifting a little. The bravest one we see so far is Paul Carberry going down the inner. Straight Talk just pecks badly on landing there. But Joe White, how I broke my leg off him, I'll never know. He jumped absolutely super. All jumping quite well at this stage.
At least I broke mine off Black Humour, and even he hurt Jamie Osborne.
But now this is the interesting thing, of course, having jumped a big one, the smallest fence on the course. I mean, kids' ponies would jump this.
Yeah, I tell you what is really interesting. We want to keep our eye on Paul Carberry. He's about fourth in the red there. He really gains a lot of ground at Canal Turn here now as we straighten up to it. We'll see. There is Paul Carberry in the inside in the red. There on the outside here is Brad and Robert Bellamy here on Crappily Lad. But they go a little bit wide here, and it may have been the difference between winning and losing. You always point this out, look, he really jumps it well, but that's what you don't want to do. And you will look at Paul there on the inside, turned really sharply, and that's put him back in the race, and he's able to give his horse a little breather. It's a lovely feeling, isn't it, going back over these fences?
Super. He's nearly ended up back in front here going to this fence, and again he can just sit back and take his time. Graham Bradley again in front, great jump.
But when you consider that Paul only in the end wins by a neck, it may have been the Canal Turn that actually won the race for him.
As I say, it's a lovely feeling now going back across these fences. Your temptation is to keep going longer and longer.
Keep going forward and keep asking for everything, because once you've got this far, you know you've a chance.
See the horse prick his ears there, weighing it up. Crappery Lad, good jump, didn't deserve to fall.
No, just beginning to race now and quarting. And there's McGoney Beach just coming into the picture. Yes. McGoney Geach just coming to the pitch. I thought Jonathan Ladd, another man who doesn't get the credit he deserves, giving this a lovely ride. And I think this is the fence that he puts down with Brad's looking for the stride. You'll see a long one in a minute. Yes, going long. Go on, my man. No, he says. And wasn't he clever there? Lovely.
I think that was the last ditch, Skew, and I actually watched him jump the chair, and he did exactly the same thing, and the horse full marks to the horse for getting out of it. Super.
But when I was saying these wide fences, you want a horse to get in close to the ditch. He's not going to stand off too far. He's very clever.
To be able to operate here. Paul Carberry just behind, just asking his horse to jump there. Just behind Straight Talk, who ran well as well. But you can see John and Lowe arriving the outside now on McGoney Beach. Just the right time, did everything right.
And in behind them, there's Channel Pastime in the light blue. Master Boston making some ground. But it's going to be these four. Now, Paul Carberry back in fourth place, just sitting and holding. But at this stage, it looked very much as if McGoney Beach had come there on the bridle. I did see him finish lame and he was led in. I can imagine my wife Mandy, who bred this horse, pulled him out herself, you know, when he was all wet and in a bag, going mad at this point.
Yes, I I feel so sorry for Jonathan, because all the way from now he gives this the most tremendous ride. He gives him a couple of smacks up the running, and when things aren't going well, the old horse has put his head in the air, he's put his stick down, he gets another run. But let's concentrate on all the runners not there. Brad is trying to save now, very, very sensible. He's got his horse in a good position, and now we're coming to the second last now, where we see very often see so many fallers. But Paul Carberry behind there just still having to work a little bit.
Yes, he's just giving him a smack now, but I've seen this horse run in Ireland and it does stay really well. Brad, as you said, in front, he's just keep trying to spare a bit. It's a long way from here to the line. Paul Carberry, he's just sitting quiet here now. This, as we know, is the tricky fence, and I think he knows it as well, and jumped it well in the finish.
But you know, we mustn't forget the horses just in behind, because Sailor Jim hasn't been mentioned yet. Paul Dalton's horse there is right in behind. Chris Maud on board, a good tryout for him for the National.
Yes, you're so right. We concentrate on the front runners, and actually it's such a thrill to go and jump round these track. Everybody, all the boys that have got in will be really delighted to jump.
Also,
up.
Master Boston, the other great air under Lorcan Weir, you know, another horse ran a super race.
Here they are coming to up the lot, this long running now, and you can see Magoni Beach, something's just playing him up there, he's not happy. Jonathan's very wisely keeping him going, keeping him wide, he's waiting for his stick until he comes to the straight bit, changing his hands, doing everything right there. And Paul Carberry on the left in the red colours as well, now Jonathan's giving him a smack, really having to work on his horse. Brad must think he's nearly got it in the bag, he must be so disappointed.
Yes, Brad really has done everything perfect. And once he met the rail, pulled his stick through to his right hand and looked as if he'd keep his horse's head down and run all the way to the line. But P. Carberry on the outside is not giving up, and tremendous race to the line.
We talk about the stick and use of the stick, but this running is so long, you're tempted to use the stick more, and you know as much as anybody, it's so tiring. The sooner you go for a horse, the more tired you get yourself.
Yes, it's meant to be the ace, and you don't want to play it too soon, do you? But in the end, what an incredible finish after 2.6 miles over these National fences. Well, not a length separating the first three.
No, a really great race, and three fantastic riding performances by all three jockeys.
But yes, Paul Carberry takes the honours, and he gets the 10% of the prize.
Yes, very happy looking man there.
Lovely to see them, isn't it? Really, really
amazing
lovely to
see
that.
Paul Carberry, you talk about people need saddles, but he hasn't even got a stamp on this horse's back. He has nothing there. So he was in the sauna earlier, so fair play to him.
Wearing his red gloves there, they'll be the fashion from now on.
I'm sure. Big problem with them, Scu, you're supposed to keep your hands down, and if you don't, everyone will see them at home.
Great race, great riding. Checking the result, Joe White the winner, 33-1. Second, Go Universal, yeah. 9-1. Third, Mugoni Beach, 33. And fourth, Straight Talk, 16-1. And the great news is that none of the horses or jockeys who came to grief in that race, none of them was in any way injured. And now we can join the presentation ceremony to the winner, which Richard's going to describe.
Yes, indeed. It is Susie Hughes presenting here to Sue Johnson, the winning trainer and owner's wife, in actual fact. George Tobbitt had already taken the winning trophy on behalf of Howard Johnson, who's busy doing other things. But Susie Hughes, a very popular person up here.
Yeah, wonderful to see Susie Hughes here, and the old man would really have enjoyed that race. 33-1 winner, but what a battle it was up that running. We now move on to the big four-year-old race of the day. It's the Glenlivet Anniversary Hurdle. Fascinating race, plenty of horses that ran at Cheltenham in the Triumph, rematched here. Runners and riders from Peter.
Number two is Amla, written by Brendan Powell. Number three, Danjing, now written by Graham Bradley in place of Jamie Osborne. Four, Edelweiss de Moulin, written by Paul Carberry. Five, Flowback, John Kavanagh. Six, Marchand Ming, Mark Dwyer. Seven, No Pattern, Lorcan Weir. Eight, R. Chris, Blinkered, written by Mick Fitzgerald. Nine is Zabadi, written by Tony McCoy. 10, Debutant Days, Jason Titley. 11, Hatter Breeze, Richard Dunwoody. And 12, Mr. Gert, written by Carl Llewellyn.
And we have joint favourites here. 3-1, Edelweiss du Moulin and Debutant Days, 3-1 each. 5-1 then, Mr. Get and Hatter Breeze. 6-1, Our Chris from 5. 7-1, Zabadi. 10-1, Marchand Ming. That was well backed with Victor Chandler this morning. 14-1, Danjing. Then 50s, No Pattern and Amla. 66-1, Flowback.
Fascinating race this. It's for the four-year-olds, of course. A lot of them have met each other already this season, and different track this from Cheltenham, Scu. Anything can happen here.
Just walking out there was Mickey Hammond. He's trains Marchant King, and he won the this race for George Moore, who's also got a winner and got a runner here. And be interesting if he's trying to do the same, bring the same pattern in bringing March and Ming back to win this race. But here's one that must have an outstanding chance. 3-1 joint favourite, fell at Cheltenham, but she's got very, very good form with the Triumph winner.
Yes, as they come through here, you can see the first runner is Lorcan Warren, no pattern. Ken Higson's colours. After him, Paul Carberry on Edelweiss de Moulin in the very well-known Robert Ogden colours. He could well end up leading owner this season. He's really putting a lot into it now. Weiss, a lovely young horse. And after him, the well-known colours of the Million in Mind partnership, five. This is the fifth one. Mick Fitzgerald on board here for Nicky Henderson, the trainer. Then the stars, after that, the green and the white stars. Jenny Mould's colours, Hatter Breeze. The Moulds bred this filly, sold it a race on the flat, and then bought her back again, and she has a live chance here. Lovely animal, that Hatter Breeze. After that, we have Tony McCoy on Zabardi. I expect him to run much better here than Cheltenham. I think the course will suit him. Mark Dwyer then on Marchant Ming, the orange sleeves and the white V, the winner of his last two. After him, the bottom one, Carl Llewellyn on Mistinget. This filly by Duan, good form. And then the light of Danjing. He was blinkered at Cheltenham, he's not blinkered here. Then Brendan Powell going out on Amla for Philip Hobbs. And after him, the spots of Jason Titley and debutant days, this filly by Dominion. Very, very useful. She cost 32,000. Shirley Brasher picked that one out herself. And what a good job she did. And John Kavanagh then coming out on Jerry Enright's Flowback with the blinkers on there, or the visor in actual fact. Very little difference between blinkers and violets, visors, but skew these four-year-olds on this fast track, you know, they're all flatbred.
Fast track, you've said it again, Richard. What they'll try and do is, I think they'll try and kick early, and that is a temptation there for horses not to get home. There's a long straight here, and horses tend to come behind on up the running here. When we think of Cheltenham as an out-and-out staying track, I always think this track is a very, very difficult track to ride because it's so sharp and the standard of these horses are so good. So it'll be interesting to see where these horses try and come from into the straight.
Yes, here we saw a little bit briefly earlier, debutante days. In fact, I think she costs 29, not 32. But what a nice sort. Wasn't great on the flat skew, but a tough individual.
Talking about sires, strong Gale early on. This is by a very good sire in Dominion. Martin Pipe used to buy a lot of horses by this and do really well. I'm surprised that he didn't try to pick this up at the sale, but they are really tough characters, and this is one of them. I've watched it win with her win all her races. She was very impressive at Sandown when she beat Paddy's Return and Mistinget that day. She then won at Uttoxeter, and that was at good form. She's a real tough little filly and gallops all the way to the line. She'll be a real tough nut to crack.
Yes, 3-1 favourite at the moment. Sheepskin. Now this is a nice animal, Edelweiss de Moulin, Robert Ogden's horse. A good horse in France, this one. Would have been encountering soft ground on that occasion and has done very, very little wrong. Actually, Ferdy Murphy was very annoyed about this one not quite getting in at Cheltenham, but he showed last time, even though it was a substandard race, it won very easily, Scu.
Yes, Edelweiss de Moulin was behind debutant days at Uttoxeter, and that does look very, very good form on this faster ground. Different race is quite entitled to reverse the placings.
Yes, indeed, they certainly are both in with a big squeak. Well, in the green and white colours of Jenny Mould, colours you know very well, Scu, Hatter Breeze, trained by David Nicholson, and this, it's a lovely story, is because the Moulds bred it by Night Shift, and they sold it for quite a bit of money to go on the flat and then bought it back for a fraction.
Yes, I saw it as a foal in Jenny's yard. I tried to persuade her not to sell it and send it us jumping, but quite rightly she sold it and did well on the flat. I love this filly as well. She won at Newbury. She beat a horse at ours at Newbury and really came there travelling well. A bit unlucky in the Triumph, made a mistake coming down the hill, but came there with every chance. I think well, you know, the Triumph form, you've got to look back and see where the others were unlucky, and there were several unlucky runners in that race, and she could have been one of them.
Yes, of course, in the Triumph, she actually finished fourth and then was promoted to third after the stewards' inquiry there. But again, very, very different track. Cheltenham is tough and stiff. This is fast and furious, and the two are chalk and cheese.
There's Miss Danguet. I called her Miss Danguet, which is totally wrong, but she's I think she's named after a French singer or something like that, and there she is. I think we gave Carl the wrong orders on her at Cheltenham. She didn't seem to get home at Sandown, and we told him to hold her up a little bit at Cheltenham, but in fact she galloped all the way to the line, so I think he'll be kicking a little bit earlier on her than at he did at Cheltenham, so it'll be interesting to see if our views are right.
Yep. Well, there are plenty of the horses here actually ran in the Triumph Hurdle at Cheltenham. And here is Ken Hickson colours, Lorcan Wire, already a winner under his belt today. Just altering the saddle, he probably felt that it had slipped a bit. You can see they use an elasticated breast girth on this. Gary Moore, the trainer, main trainer for Ken Hickson now. And no pattern, just the one run. He was quite a good mile and a half flat horse, you know. And he just couldn't get to Kilcoram Bay at Windsor. I think that he'd certainly need to improve a bit on that.
I spoke to Ken Hickson, one of the real characters of racing. He's had a lot of horses. A really nice fellow. He says this horse has got no chance. I don't know whether he's telling me the truth or not.
People wouldn't dare tell you, Porkies.
And Debutante Days and Edelweiss Dumoulin, the best backed horses this morning. Just favourite Debutante Days at 130, Edelweiss Dumoulin 72. Miss Danguet, friend list from 4-1 out to 6-1. 6-1 our Chris from 5, 13-2, bar those four.
Number two, Amla, who was brought down in the Triumph Hurdle. Do you think that worries a young horse, Skew?
Not if they go back and school. I mean, if it continues to happen, yes, it does worry them. But the form doesn't look good enough, does it?
Brendan Powell on board. And Philip Hobbs, the trainer of this one, he gets some very good young horses. Good trainer, Philip Hobbs. 50s from 33s, so that reflects the price somewhat. Back off Dan Jing because they were put on at Cheltenham, thought it would improve him.
I know the history of this horse. I was at Newmarket when Dan Jing was claimed out of Paul Cole's stable at because Simon Sherwood is a mate of Paul Cole. Richard Green, who's got many horses, has bought this horse, and it's done very, very well. But I know Simon was saving the blinkers for the Triumph Hurdle, but now he's taken the blinkers off. Obviously didn't work at Cheltenham that day. 16-1 from 14-1.
So 5 is Flowback, Jerry Enright's horse, but he's got to find a fair bit on his form. He's by Royal Academy. He's 101 from 66-1. John Kavanagh will enjoy his ride here, but I very much doubt whether we'll see a 101 winner in this. Well, one that we haven't seen, well, we'll catch up on them. But 11-4, Debutant Days, Edelweiss de Moulin 4s, 6s on the drift, Miss Danguet, Chris is 6s, 13-2 had a breeze, the Bardi 8s, the same price, March and Ming, and that's been back. 2 points March and Ming, a horse that we haven't seen. He'll be with Mark Dwyer on board, but he's only right on the tapes there. One from the right as we look at it, but Jerry Scott about to get them off.
Before they go, I think March and Ming, I've heard, there's a big tip for that horse today. One on the heavy ground, faster ground today, see how he handles it.
Come on, there's a filly here, and this was proper.
And they're running, and Dan Jing it is nearest to us, and on the far side R Chris the leader from Dan Jing in the early stages, Marchant Ming, and then comes Miss Danguet as they race towards the first flight. Long run to it. Our Chris from Dan Jing, Marchant Ming and Miss Danguet. And over on the far side, No Pattern. Just in behind them, Amla, Debutante Days. At the second, Ah, Chris Danjing, Marchant Ming, Mistanget. No pattern on the far side. Hatter Breeze up with the pace. Edelweiss de Moulin over on the far rail. About ninth at the moment. Over the third. Ah, Chris and Danjing from Marchant Ming and No Pattern. And then Amlar and Mistanget and Hatter Breeze. Then Debutant Days. Then Zabadi. Then Edelweiss de Moulin. And the back marker is Flowback. But still, R. Chris Makey from Danjing on the outside. Marchant Ming comes next, and then Mistanget. Then on the inside, No Pattern. On the outside is Hatter Breeze. Amlar on the inside there. And comes Zabadi. Debutant Days. Behind them, Edelweiss de Moulin. And still, the back marker is Flowback. And still up front is the Million in Mind partnership horse. And we lost Edelweiss de Moulin on the flat there. Edelweiss de Moulin went on the flat. And still up front at the fifth. R. Chris. R. Chris disputing it from Danjing. Marchant Ming on the inside. Debutant Day is making ground towards the outside. Mistanget still well in touch too. This is the last over on the far side. R. Chris and Danjing, these two from Marchant Ming, Mistanget. And on the far side, Debutant Days looking to the left now. You see Debutant Days with the sheepskin noseband, but still up front. It's R. Chris and Danjing, then Mistanget, then Marchant Ming. Then comes Debutant Days towards the outside with Hatter Breeze next. Still R. Chris and Mick Fitzgerald from Danjing. They've got three left to jump. Mistanget, Marchant Ming, Debutant Days being pushed along, and on the near side, Amla beginning to get into it too. Racing towards the third last flight now in this Glenlivet anniversary four-year-old novices hurdle. And still R. Chris is the Million in Mind colours from Danjing and Mistanget. R. Chris landed in the lead from Danjing, Mistanget, and over on the far side, Marchant Ming. Zabadi coming with a good run too, with his white face towards the left of the picture. But it was R. Chris still there from Danjing, and Zabadi coming there still towards the near side under pressure is R. Chris. And Zabadi motoring now and coming down to the final flight. Zabadi's going to jump it in the lead, and it puts in a mighty leap at that. Zabadi, the leader from R. Chris and Danjing, as they race into the closing stages. It's Zabadi under Tony McCoy, who's been second three times this afternoon, making no mistake this time, striding up towards the line to win this. Oh, very comfortably indeed on Zabadi. Zabadi the winner with R. Chris second and third, Danjing, and fourth was Mistanget. And very disappointing was Debutant Days, who actually finished last of the 11 to complete, with Edelweiss de Moulin, a faller on the flat under Paul Carberry over on the far side. But this is the winner, number nine, Zabadi, owned by Lady Harris, trained by David Nicholson, and written by Deep Brambles Martel Grand National jockey Tony McCoy. Second was number eight, R. Chris, owned by the Million in Mind Partnership, section five, trained by Nicky Henderson and ridden by Mick Fitzgerald. And third was number three, Danjing, owned by Richard Green Fine Paintings, trained by Simon Sherwood and ridden by Graham Bradley, with fourth number 12, Mistanget. And there is Edelweiss de Moulin, who slipped up on the flat and appears to be unhurt. So, Tony McCoy finally on a winner this afternoon, the season's leading rider on an 8-1 winner. In fact, his 133rd winner of the season. Kabadi by Sharastani out of Zazaya by Beldale Flutter. Winner of three of his six races now, the official margin six lengths and one length, and a 65th winner of the season for his trainer, David Nicholson. Zabadi returning after a really dramatic finish at the end of this Glenlivet anniversary hurdle and a sensational leap at the final flight. Now here goes Edelweiss de Moulin, just rounding this turn here, flying 10th at the time. Could have been a very nasty fall, but it's very difficult to account for why he should have lost his footing there, as this winner returns to the circle where Tony McCoy will be hoping to be at the end of the Martel National on Saturday. He rides deep bramble, and his nearest victim here, Mick Fitzgerald, is on the current favourite, Rough Quest. Mr. Ngetz is just, you saw a moment ago behind him, written by Carl Llewellyn, and he, of course, will be on Party Politics on Saturday. There he is in the background. And Paul Carberry was able to walk into the ambulance, so get a lift back, so hopefully he is unscathed after that fall on the level, which can be very nasty. The favourite backers still not on the best of terms with themselves. The starting price is as follows.
And Zabadi the winner at 8-1. Second Arcris 13-2, and third Danjing at 16-1. And the totes there win £11.40, places £2.70, £1.70, £4. The dual forecast paid £28.30, and the straight forecast £54.83.
Yes, what a lovely race Tony McCoy's ridden here. I know David Nicholls will be delighted because he's had a winner, but he'll also be delighted in the way that Tony has ridden this race. He loves his jockeys to ride a race. We were talking about them kicking early in the straight, and there you see Arcris in front, Danjig chasing along with Brad, but there, number nine in the yellow, is Tony McCoy. He's given him, just getting a lovely pull, as they call it, off those horses, giving himself plenty of room, come to the second last, and allowed the horse to use his finishing speed.
An incredible jumper. You know, all these, you've got to remember, are flatbred horses, but he had ridden a good race, of course he had. He produced it, and now he's got the comfort of sitting. He's gone there and he's done it, and he's just going to save that bit more. But just watch this horse when he goes to the last. He really picks up. I mean, the bravery here as he goes, that's terrific jump.
Yes, really is. And what's also interesting is that we filmed this horse schooling early in the season. It was shown at BBC at Ascot, and he didn't jump that well that time. And to start with, he wasn't running very well over hurdles, but now he's really getting his jumping together and really going well.
And the difference in the form from the Triumph Hurdle, where stablemate Hatter Breeze, who's the left of the picture, just going out, finished in front of this one, an easier track. Now, this horse still came there with a chance at Cheltenham, then faded up the hill. So it's the easier course for me and this ground.
Yeah, see, he's been doing his winning on the soft ground. When you were saying that the track may help him, I thought to myself, no, you're wrong again, Pitman, I thought to myself. But no, you were right.
Do I take that as an apology?
That's an apology. Really.
But a very wide winning. And here is Paul Carberry. Well, Paul, who had the triumph of the last race of the big fences, now he received quite a kick there when he fell, but he is okay. So there's Paul Carberry smiling after a fall, but we can go down and join Jonathan Powell with winning trainer David Nicholson.
Yes, David, you certainly enjoyed that victory by Zabadi, which was really his form before Cheltenham. Perhaps Cheltenham was a little bit too uphill for him.
Well, it's possible that it was. I mean, he's won at Kempton twice, won on a flat track. He was a 7 furlong horse in Ireland, and I told Tony to ride him for foot today, and he's done it. He might have got there a bit too soon, to be fair.
But he's looked a pretty decent horse today.
I hope he is. Yeah. Unfortunately, the owners aren't here, but no doubt they would have enjoyed it watching on television.
On Saturday, you're going to be watching on television, because unusually you don't have a runner in the Grand National, or indeed on the big day.
think it's the first national I've missed since, no, I missed one since 51 or 52, 51, when I had jaundice and couldn't come, the year Anglo one. I haven't missed one since. I haven't got a runner, so I should watch on television.
And today, distressing news that your long-time owner, Brigadier Roscoe Harvey, died this morning. You thought the world of him.
The Brig, as I knew him and a lot of other people knew him, has been like a father to me over the last 35 years. I've known him and Jenny and everybody for a very long time. Great person. Always, I mean, his wife had horses with me, and in fact I rode her a winner on No Defence at Towcester. His lifetime ambition was to win the Military Gold Cup, and luckily Philip, my eldest son, managed to win on Burnt Oak, which I think was one of the most special days of my racing career, to win the Military Gold Cup for the Brig.
Happy memories.
Very.
And so say all of us. Well, so we come to the end of a terrific first day of the Grand National Meeting. If you've only just come in, this is what's happened so far.
Still plenty in with a chance as they come to the last. Charming Girl from Kemeniki. Tragic Hero getting through on the inside. Then on the outside, Shankar and Master Bevel. And Tragic Hero's come through on the inside to take it up with 150 yards to race. Tragic Hero from Charming Girl, Kemeniki, Shankar and Castle Sweep. But going up to the line, Tragic Hero and Jonathan Lauer win from Charming Girl. Castle Sweep stays on to be third, ahead of Kemeniki, Shankar and Master Bevel.
A shock result in the first race of the meeting. Tragic Hero returned at 20 to 1 and paying £37.20 on the tote.
Coming down to the final fence now, and it's the two that have matched each other throughout, with Scotton Banks the leader from Barton Bank by a good two lengths as he comes to the last. Scotton Banks under Lorcan Wire lands two lengths near a Barton Bank, who makes a shocking blunder, only just gets away with it under Tony McCoy, and that has definitely handed the race to Scotton Banks, who wins it deservedly, races past the winning post. The winner second is Barton Bank, and third Unguided Missile.
Scotton Banks giving trainer Tim Easterby an Aintree winner in his first season as a trainer. Returned at 9-2.
Lord Dorset takes it up now as they come to the final ditch. At the final ditch, Lord Dorset from Ask Tom. Lord Dorset on the near side, Ask Tom. Lord Dorset's nearly gone there. Ask Tom has got the advantage again. And Ask Tom is wavering off a true line, but he still has a clear advantage. Manhattan Castle is finishing like a train, but he's got a lot to do. Coming to the final fence now and losing concentration in the lead. This Ask Tom, but looks as though he's only going to jump it. Ask Tom, he jumps it well. Ask Tom, and jumping in second is Lord Dorset, and third, Cable Beach, the longtime leader. Four is Manhattan Castle, and as they race up towards the line, Ask Tom wins the Sandham and McGull novices chase. Second is Lord Dorset, and third is Cable Beach, and fourth is Manhattan Castle.
Ask Tom giving Thomas Tate consolation for his unhappy news earlier of Lo Stregoni, and Peter Nevin replacing Jamie Osborne, who broke his collarbone in the previous race. Ask Tom returned at 10-1.
But as they come down to the final fence now, it's Go Universal and Magoni Beach. These two still disputing it. They land in unison. Go Universal on the far side, Magoni Beach on the near side. Straight Talk and Joe White come next, and they're being chased by Master Boston as they race towards the elbow. Go Universal on the far side, Magoni Beach on the near side. And here comes Joe White to make it a threesome as they race into the closing stages. Go Universal being chased now by Joe White with a white face on the near side. But it's still Go Universal, but Joe White is beginning to get up. Joe White is getting up on the near side, and it's going to be a photo. Joe White may have just won it in a photo from Go Universal, with Magoni Beach between horses. Straight Talk came behind them.
A stunning ride by Tommy Carberry's son, Paul, for Joe White to win the big race over the big fences on the first day at 33-1.
And still are Chris as the Million in Mine colours. from Danjing and Mistanget. Chris landed in the lead from Danjing, Mistanget, and over on the far side, March and Ming. Zabadi coming with a good run too, with his white face towards the left of the picture. But it was Chris still there from Danjing, and Zabadi coming there still towards the near side under pressure. Is Chris and Zabadi motoring now and coming down to the final flight. Zabadi's going to jump it in the lead, and it puts in a mighty leap at that. Zabadi, the leader from Chris and Danjing, as they race into the closing stages. It's Zabadi under Tony McCoy, who's been second three times this afternoon, making no mistake this time, striding up towards the line to win this. Oh, very comfortably indeed on Zabadi. Zabadi the winner with Chris second and third, Danjing, and fourth was Mistanget.
Tony McCoy giving Zabadi a terrific ride to win the Glenlivet at 8-1. Poor Adrian McGuire, an onlooker. Well, the big news of the day, of course, is the withdrawal of Lo Stregoni from the Grand National. He's suffering from influenza. A big blow for Thomas Tate's stable, because this horse was really primed to win the race. We spoke to Thomas earlier and asked him exactly what happened.
Did it come about? On Tuesday night, we took his the pre-race blood test, and we had a suspicion then. But the horse was fine. He was like a fighting cock. So we just watched him, and on Wednesday he was a bit quieter. On Wednesday night he had a temperature, and he had a temperature this morning, and he left his breakfast this morning, and he was quiet this morning. And that's not him.
So that was it. Is that him finished for the season?
Well, an unhappy start to the day for Thomas Tate, but it was a day that started badly and got a little bit worse, I'm afraid, for Jamie Osborne. Jamie, first of all, sickening about Lo Stregoni.
Yeah, I mean, I heard this morning when I was driving up here, and obviously I was very disappointed, because I felt that he gave me my best chance so far of winning the race.
Then came black humour and a certain amount of pain.
Yeah, you know, it's just the way the season's gone a little bit for me. Obviously, I haven't had as much bad luck as normal, at least I've been riding, but you know, the winners haven't flowed this year. Cheltenham was a disaster. A lot of good horses that I had to ride have gone wrong, and I think this has probably paid to my season, so we'll start again next year.
Well, this was a mother and father of a fall.
Well, I
it?
Haven't seen it. Oh, here we are.
Well, don't shut your eyes. You're on the left in the pink.
Oh, yeah.
9.9 for artistic impression.
Someone said to me earlier, I don't know why I didn't stay on him. I'm glad I didn't stay on him. I think I'd have been squashed.
Had to beat, but amazingly the horse was okay.
Well, that's the good news, yeah.
And then half an hour later, you missed a £35,000 race on Tom.
Yeah, you know, this happened time and time again this year. Every time I've had a little injury, I've had a few injuries and a few suspensions, and each time it's happened, I've missed decent winners, so I'm actually becoming quite accustomed to it. You know, after choosing to ride my silver in the champion hurdle and watching Collier Bay win, I think I'm prepared for anything.
Well, at least you can go out and have a good dinner. I'm sure you will. Yeah. Right, Lo Stregoni, one of four withdrawals from the Martel Grand National. This is the list: Lo Stregoni, Tartan Tyrant, Dextra Dove, and Too Good to Be True. And that leaves 28 in the big race with Rough Quest, now once again a clear favourite. He's top priced at 5-1. 6-1 Superior finish, 7-1 the fast ground horse Young Hustler, 8-1 Ireland's Son of War. Deep Bramble, well, the ground's going against him. He's 9-1, as is Party Politics. He's a top of the ground horse, as is Life of the Law, the man of Charlie Swan. 14-1 Wild Hyde, he likes the soft. Last Delight, 20-1, Encore and Perth, 25, Rust Never Sleeps, 33, Antonin, 33, as is Bishop's Hall, Marcus Armitage, 50-1, Captain Dibble, and Sir Peter Leely, and Into the Red, as is Chatham, and Over the Deal, last year's third. It's 66-1, Vicomte de Valmont, and Bavardier. Riverside Boys, an 80-1 shot, described by his trainer as an old dog. Plastic Space Age is 100-1, as is Over the Stream and Brackenfield. Green Hill Raffles likewise changed hands earlier this week. 150-1, the Far Senior and Three Brownies. And 200-1, the outsider of the whole field, Shaw Metal. Well, Rough Quest now looking a very short price favourite indeed, or is he? Because he's eased twice this week already. He's out to 5-1. Mike Dillon's with us. Is he going to start favourite or not?
I'm not sure he is, Julian. The combination of Jenny Pitman and Richard Dunwoody is gathering momentum with superior finish. And I think the fact that Cheltenham and Aintree are so close this year is putting punters off, and I think they're going to wait for the day if they're going to back him. And it wouldn't surprise me if Superior Finish had the call for favouritism on the day.
But it's not going to be his ground, is it?
It's not, no, but I mean, once that ball gets rolling, I mean, people believe in Jenny and Dunwoody can do no wrong in the punters' eyes. So I think with Rough Quest, you know, the fact he wasn't going to run for so long, you know, the punters haven't had any chance to get to grips with him, and I don't see him being that popular on the day.
Well, horses are going out, falling down like leaves off a tree. It must be a terrific anti-post book for the bookmakers.
Well, it's been very quiet, really. I mean, we didn't have any activity until November, when Young Hustler put up that tremendous performance winning here, and punters wanted to be on him at 20-1. There was very quiet then until the weights. And until Lo Stregoni won the Green Old Whitley, you know, the market didn't splutter into action. But this week we introduced the non-runner, no-bet proviso, so that's sharpened the thing up. And quite a few horses have been backed, and I think significantly Life of a Lord has been well supported today. I think when people saw that the ground was drying out and it might come his ground, I think there's been quite a few quid from over the water for him, but very quiet on the anti-post front.
Mike, thank you. Norman, in 10 seconds, is Son of the War going to win?
I think the weather now is a big thing. Skew is here smiling with Young Hustler. Life of a Lord must have a chance, but the likes of Wild Hyde, Son of War, I'd be getting worried now.
Norman, thank you. Mike? We're back tomorrow with four more races and a fascinating race for the Mum Melling Chase, which brings together those three that took part in that, well, the race of the week at Cheltenham, really, for the Queen Mother Champion Chase. A great prologue to the National, that. The National now less than 48 hours away. For the first time ever, we know the Grand National runners on the Thursday, but we're no nearer to finding the winner. Goodbye.
Come on!